Well, I'm going to jump the shark intentionally at the start of the next segment. So call your friends and family and tell them to tune into the broadcast. When we start the next segment in exactly 7 minutes, 12 seconds from now. So start the countdown. Get ready. Because we are going to be breaking down some information that may actually shake large portions of the population out of their mind control. And if people join me in this movement, if you join me in what I'm going to announce and what I'm going to launch, we're going to have news articles about it later this afternoon, special reports, you name it. It's going to have a gigantic, huge effect. Last night I thought about doing this when I went to bed, and I got up this morning and thought about it and was mulling it around in my mind. And then right as we went live, we're talking a minute and a half ago, I said, you know what, I'm doing it. So if you want to destroy the tyranny that is political correctness that is designed to end free speech and everything else we know, join me in what we're about to push at the start of the next segment. Call your friends, call your family. We need to tweet right now at Real Alex Jones that I'm going to make an incredibly important announcement, and then a link, Infowars.com/show, so everybody can watch and listen to the free feeds and hear this breakdown. And then Paul Watson's going to be joining me, obviously, to discuss at the bottom of the hour the Chattanooga shooting. We got 4 dead, 3 wounded. The 5th person dead, of course, is a purported shooter. There's a lot of witnesses. I don't think this is a false flag. And you notice I'm right again, hundreds of times. If you're a regular listener, you know this, but we've played the clips. Hundreds of times I've said Islamic State is real. Islamic State is a real terror threat. Islamic State is not controlled by the West. Islamic State is a bag of black widows that the globalists basically allowed to breed, funded, protected, shepherded, and now have allowed to come into the West. They've foiled more attacks on French military bases today. On July 4th, they had to cancel July 4th celebrations in the UK for U.S. troops on base. And I'm on record hundreds of times in the last few years saying they'll attack recruiting offices, military bases, guard gates, shopping malls, Christian schools, Jewish schools, and other facilities. Now, I'm the guy that wrote the book on exposing false flag, and I mean, I'm proud of the fact, got inside job and synthetic attack and terms like false flag into the nomenclature, into the common parlance. Because Al-Qaeda itself is a Saudi Arabian synthetic operation with criminals in our government allowing it to operate, but very small, mainly a PR front. ISIS is a Western-funded, protected, not run. It's like having wild dogs in a pit you feed raw meat. They don't follow your orders, but you've gotten them ready. It's like a wild bull they release on a matador. Nobody controls that bull in the stalls. It's kept wild and vicious, but there are people that tend it and take care of it and then, you know, open the gate and turn it loose. It's the same thing. And they're going to use this to take our liberties, which they're now doing. House committee passed legislation to create special domestic terror unit the day before Chattanooga shooting. And they say their main mission is gun owners, veterans, conservatives, libertarians. That'll be setting us up while they bring in record numbers of radical Islamicists that they have basically allowed to grow strong, a 200,000 man army. We're going to break down the tragic Chattanooga shootings that left 4 Marines dead, 3 wounded, and the sole gunman reportedly dead. I am going to be breaking down for you here today exactly what I think about this situation and what is going to come in the aftermath. We have a House committee that passed legislation to create a special domestic terror unit the day before the Chattanooga shooting. that Homeland Security and the FBI say their main target is gun owners, veterans, conservatives, Christians, libertarians. That's on record. So they're going domestic. We told you after 9/11 it would be used to overturn the Bill of Rights and Constitution. 9/11 has definitely done that. 15 years after 9/11, roughly, we have a 200,000-plus person army ranging around the Middle East, overthrowing our allies, murdering Christians, murdering non-radical extremist Muslims, and attacking multiple times in France, multiple times in North Africa, all over Kuwait, and now two attacks inside the United States. The attack, of course, in Garland a month and a half ago, and now the attack in Chattanooga, Tennessee. Now, that said, in the political correct world that we live in and that the average American is bombarded with, when a deranged young man on amnesiac drugs goes into a Charleston, South Carolina church and brutally murders 9 innocent black people at point-blank range because they were black, and he shows photos of himself with a Confederate flag, they have pulled it down in multiple states. They are banning it off of most stores. They are banning people from selling it on eBay. They are demonizing it. They're calling for taking down statues of Confederate generals. They're calling for getting rid of the Maryland State Song. Separately, all over the U.S., they're removing the word boy and girl in school, saying it's hurtful to people that aren't boys or girls. They're removing the name father or mother in California and other states, or husband or wife, because the fact that someone could be a husband and wife and they're not included, well, it has to be banned. Well, you know what? What if you feel it's hurtful that record numbers of Muslims are being brought in from countries known to be radicalized and to hate Westerners, to hate liberals, to hate gays, to hate women being free, and who want to attack U.S. military installations, and who want to attack soft targets? ISIS is a real multi-hundred-thousand person army, 15 years after 9/11, giving up so many of our liberties. Did we get more security? No. And our borders wide open, because the terror threats are being used to take our freedoms. The Patriot Act is used 99%+ of the time against non-terror-related cases to overturn the Bill of Rights and Constitution. Now, that said, political correctness, if anything is hurtful to anyone, they're saying it's banned. That's totalitarianism. So what we need is some strong medicine to force the logical point, to force the debate, to have the controlled traitor media attack us for making this point, and then to have the American public have a logical discussion. Now, they will take what I'm about to say out of context. This is a big announcement. But it's not done satirically. It's done at a level of logical discussion. If we're going to ban paper bags that are brown in Seattle government because someone might be hurt that they're brown bags, no one ever said brown bags, anything to do with racism. They just say it to set the precedent they can ban or restrict whatever they want. If we're going to tell kids nationwide in public schools under No Child Left Behind, you're purple penguins, you can't be a boy or girl, it might hurt someone that doesn't identify as a boy or girl. If you can't have your identity because it might hurt someone else, that is the greatest form of oppression psychologically I could imagine. That's the wildest cult programming that I could ever even envision in my mind. Period. So to assault these people, we have to point out that what they're doing is unconstitutional, it's tyrannical, it's totalitarian, it's oppressive, it's cultic, but also it can't be selectively enforced. It can't be discriminatory. And so, if we have radical Muslims being brought in by the hundreds of thousands a year from everywhere from Turkey Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, areas of northeastern Africa like Somalia, who were then constantly getting caught trying to carry out attacks or who were carrying out attacks against soft targets. Well, if it's hurtful to people, they're doing that. And if we blame all white people for the shooter in Charleston, the deranged shooter, and if we blame the Confederate battle flag for that, then I'm calling for all Muslim symbols to be removed. And I'm calling for all mosques in the United States to be shut down. And I'm calling for all self-identifying Muslims of any type to be deported to their original country of origin, even if it was if they've been here 200 years. I want all Muslims deported now. And I want all Muslims to have their mosque shut down and their minarets removed and their symbols removed. And anyone wearing a crescent moon around their neck, I want them arrested. Because we've got police showing up at swap meets, you know, saying they're there to arrest people selling rebel flags. Total tyranny, hardcore oppression. Well, then, let's see it. Let's see if the controlled left won't just edit what I just said and we'll take it in context. Because the truth is, most Muslims aren't radicals. Most Muslims aren't terrorists. The truth is that in general, the people coming to this country just want to work and be successful and are fleeing the oppression of radical Islam. I know a lot of Muslims. I went to school with a lot of Muslims. I don't support blaming all Muslims for what just happened. But you know what? There have been a lot of Muslim groups allied with the left who are calling to remove the Confederate flag and who are getting into this whole anti-Anglo-Saxon, anti-white garbage. And so it's time for white people and anyone else that doesn't want to be oppressed to say, I'm not going to be blamed for what somebody else does. But if you want to play by that game, we know statistically over 95% of terrorism in the world is carried out by Islamic extremists, the rest by criminal groups who want ransoms. They'll point towards Oklahoma City. That's come out in mainstream news, was as phony as a $3 bill, totally set up. Southern Poverty Law Center running the white supremacist compound. But separate from that, this is the logic. This is what they're pushing. And so, if one man killing nine people, one degenerate white person who couldn't even get the Klan to follow him, committed that heinous act, then, ladies and gentlemen, we have to remove the Confederate flag, next to the American flag. Now they're calling to remove Mount Rushmore. You know what? Let's remove every symbol somebody uses in a wrong way. If somebody runs over somebody with a Ford truck, I want Ford to change its symbol, change its name, and I want, by law, every Ford symbol removed, and if you don't, $10,000 fine. And there have been people that have used Chevy cars to kill people in crowds. I want Chevy banned. There have been people that have used Toyotas to run down crowds. One guy, I remember in California, that killed like 16 people. I want that. I want Toyota banned right now. And if a Smith & Wesson gun is used, sue Smith & Wesson, shut them down. That's what's happening right now. Bushmaster's being sued by Bloomberg groups. By this logic, if anyone that works for Bloomberg ever commits a crime, he needs to be arrested as well. You see, totalitarianism works that way. If your neighbor or a guy down the street committed a crime in Nazi Germany or in Soviet Russia, you would get in trouble too. And that's how this works. Someone's offended by an American flag. So now all over the country, they tell kids, don't wear American flags at school on Cinco de Mayo or whatever. I mean, that's a joke. This is divide and conquer. So now, ladies and gentlemen, we stand at the crossroads. And if we have to blame all whites for what the shooter did in South Carolina, and everybody from CNN to MSNBC to Salon to Raw Story said that, all whites are guilty, all whites, you know, are basically deserve, you know, to be ashamed of themselves. MTV has shows about white people and you know, how inherently bad they are. even though most white people aren't related to anybody that ever had slaves. Most white people came here after slavery. Doesn't matter. Just white people are guilty. Well, then fine. All Muslims are guilty for the latest shooting, and they need to be deported to their country of origin, and their symbols need to be banned, and we need to put up tape around all the mosques and ban all their books as well. Burn them. Burn all their books. Burn the Quran. Get rid of all of it. It's racist. It's hateful. It's murderous. Everybody's guilty. You can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't say we're a free society, but then we ban every symbol and persecute Christians and say that white people are inherently bad and are guilty of crimes that other white people commit, but then say that black people aren't guilty for the crimes that other black people commit. Or it's racist to want to stop criminals fleeing Latin American justice coming up here when it's a fact that's happening. And so, I don't say it tongue-in-cheek, I want to be clear. I say it along the twisted logic of the controlled fascistic left that wants to remove freedom of speech, that you can't have your cake and eat it too. If you want to sue Bushmaster because somebody supposedly used a Bushmaster in a crime, when it's legal to sell those guns, well, then you've got to ban the car companies and the cars that are used in crime. And you got to ban knives. That's your twisted logic. And if you want to say the word father or mother is hurtful and ban it, well, it's hurtful to get shot and killed if you're four Marines. And just instinctively, I would never go out and attack a government facility offensively. But just hypothetically, I would go out and look for another group of armed people to engage. But see, that's just the innate chivalry that I have. And that's why I'm against these drones and the rest of it and robots killing people, because it takes the humanity and the empathy out of it. It's very dishonorable. And we will end up facing these drones as well. And the West has done terrible things to the Middle East. The most terrible is funding and protecting Saudi Arabia and giving them the weapons and then allowing them to carry out 9/11 and then covering it up. And the deal Saudi Arabia gets is they get to take over Iraq, they get to take out Iran, they get to launch their proxy armies, funded by them publicly, to take over the Middle East. And now their proxy armies and their fellow travelers, their bots, start attacking soft targets here. And they go, oh, we've set up a new domestic extremist group. Their main focus is veterans, gun owners, and people like that. And Christians and conservatives, and the White House is persecuting Christians and veterans and libertarian groups. You see? You see how I told you hundreds of times the last 4 years they would use the Free Syrian Army to equip a new Al-Qaeda base, because that's who they are. They changed the name to Islamic State and ISIS. They launch attacks domestically. They launch attacks all over the world, and government uses that to get more funding and more power while leaving the borders open and bringing in unskilled radical Muslims who are now on the streets in Michigan and in London in the news, coming up and beating up people drinking at outside bars and telling women, put on longer skirts, you're in a Muslim area. And then it's on local news, but nowhere else. They're bringing in intolerant people that have a Stone Age version of Islam. You can debate all day whether Islam is warlike or peaceful. I've read both the Quran and the Bible. The Bible's got passages about war and exterminating everybody. So does the Quran. So people that just quote violent parts of the Quran are taking it out of context. But it is a book of war and conquest. So are sections of the Bible. There is a time for peace, a time for war, a time to laugh, a time to cry, a time to sow, a time to reap. What part of that is it in Proverbs? Or is it in Psalms that has some great rock band made a song about it? Time of the season. See if you can find that song. We'll play it coming in. But the truth is, Islam is being radicalized by Saudi Arabia, the ones that created a whole empire out of it. A couple hundred Bedouin bank robbers, basically people that robbed the caravan, got funded by British intelligence in 1901 and went from a couple hundred square miles to what is the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. They even took over Turkey for a while. They now are being funded and allowed to take over by the West as part of their deal because the Saudis buy over $50 billion in weapons alone a year from the United States. $50 billion. They invest hundreds of billions a month in different Western companies. They have invested trillions a year. They are one of the richest countries in the world. And while everybody's obsessed on Israel or the Vatican, which certainly both those countries are involved in intrigue and power plays, and I have major problems with both those power blocks. But when you look at Saudi Arabia, it's the political correct group you're not supposed to talk about. They quarterback 9/11. Our criminal government stands down. Their archenemy, Iraq, gets taken out and blamed. And Saddam gets up and gives speeches and says that, and they call him a liar and laugh at him and have HBO movies about how evil he is. So all these stupid, geopolitically inept, geopolitically illiterate people can sit around and go, there's the bad man, say goodnight to the bad man, when Saddam Hussein never did jack crap to the United States and was a CIA officer put in control of that country to launch a war against Iran. Monday through Friday, from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central, back weeknight, 7 o'clock Central, InfoWars Nightly News, we watch as the world turns, and as the seasons turn, and as our lives go through the seasons. As above, so below. The globalists know what they're doing. They understand the seasons. They understand the rhythms, the rhymes of history. And they play us like a Stradivarius violin. It's time to stop being idiots. Now, I have given many breakdowns, especially on Monday, of the fact that I want to unify humanity around a basic code of libertarian ideas, of renaissance, of acceptance, of human freedom. Obviously, I do not want to deport all Muslims. Obviously, I do not want to have a clash of civilizations and a war between the West and the East that is meant to bring in the planetary government. But they're launching the war. They're bringing in the radicals. They're protecting him. The reported shooter, Mohammed Yousef Abdulaziz, had gone to Kuwait a bunch of times. That's where his family's from. He wasn't born here. He didn't fit in. He was good at sports. He was a nice guy, people said, but he was very stoic and very freaked out here in this culture. And let me tell you, I get freaked out in a wild culture a little bit as well, but I'm not going to go out and start shooting people. I didn't support our wars in the Middle East. I knew they were fraudulent. I knew they were to take out non-radical regimes and put radicals in. I knew they wanted to destabilize that area of the world to get the resources. I knew it was evil. But I don't blame the Marines or the Army that bought into the propaganda and followed their orders. Just like if I don't like the militarization of police and some cops doing bad things, I don't support nationwide movements to go shoot cops in their patrol cars or shoot them off the backs of motorcycles. Plus, I can go to the statistics and see that the truth is police violence isn't actually up. We are just seeing more of it because of cameras, and that does not say it's good. We're not going to reform the police having a war with them. We're going to reform them by getting involved and supporting the good ones. Because when you don't support any of them, then the bad ones are the ones that can take control, and that's why George Soros and MTV and all these TV channels make it sexy to attack the police for young people demographics. For older folks, oh, the cops can do no harm. So older folks think cops and the government's perfect. Younger people think they're the devil and need to be overthrown. Can you see how that works? Keep older people from reforming the police. Have them become corrupt so good men and women won't get involved. And then have the George Soros groups wind up crowds that are angry using a few tragedies that have happened to start a race war in this country to change the subject off of the economic conquest and degradation we're under and the fact that there's a planetary depression that we've been in for some time that is now intensifying and beginning to come to the United States. Spain has basically outlawed all basic freedoms. It wasn't since they were under Franco that they were a fascist tyranny. Spain is a socialist system with fascist-style government. It's been announced that there's no free speech, criticize the government, you're arrested in any way. report on the government, you're arrested. I mean, it's just over the top. Italy's putting similar laws in place now. Europe is collapsing. You can read the article. It's from Zero Hedge. 1984 comes to Europe, the end of freedom of speech in Spain. Even jokes about royals are illegal. If you do a cartoon about Juan Carlos, the king, being a degenerate or being a fat pig, you get arrested. Tweeting information of a organized protest. They're using the Islamic radical threat to take our freedoms. And then they have movies that are put out on HBO and stuff where they have the left defending radical Islam and saying, you know, that I'm an insane racist because I don't like radical Islam. I mean, I'm a liberal, folks. I'm a real liberal, like Thomas Jefferson. I mean, I believe you can do what you want as long as you don't hurt me. I believe in private property all the way. I believe in laissez-faire capitalism. I believe in sovereignty. I believe in parenthood. I believe that do what you want as long as you're not in somebody else's business. And these people are not liberals. These people are control freaks. The sickening socialist left and communist left, I'll see them marching with radical Islamic groups connected to ISIS here in Austin just because they're evil and nasty. They get off on it. Just because Stalin is evil and nasty and Mao, these college kids that have rich parents get into it. And then they end up being like Hillary Clinton, being co-president and secretary of state. I mean, the controlled left loves radical Islam. That chops women's genitals off and puts bags over their heads and imprisons women that get caught driving. And the third time they execute women in Saudi Arabia, they get caught driving. And I never hear anything out of Gloria Steinem's fat mouth. I mean, I am fundamentally threatened by a society that treats women like that. I mean, I like my women happy, powerful, and spoiled and taking care of me. Not chained up in some damn dungeon, excuse me. But I'm getting tired of it. I'm getting tired of a bunch of weirdo control freaks sitting up there saying they're the Renaissance, they're the liberals, trying to ban every form of free speech in this country, but the most radical, violent crud. And nobody's going to walk up to me and tell me what I'm going to do on the street when I don't care if it's a cop or if it's a radical Islamicist or the military or who it is. I'm going to engage in the First Amendment. I'm going to engage in the Second Amendment. You ban having firearms in San Antonio, open carry, when the state law says that I can, I'm going to go down there with 1,500 people, and I'm going to break your phony law right in front of you, ready for the challenge. We're not playing games, New World Order. Get that through your head. And let me tell you, you think you're going to activate a bunch of sleeper cells in this country? This guy was definitely being handled by ISIS. Out of our little ally, Kuwait, and the other attackers, Saudi Arabia. That's who runs the terrorism. It's a globalist shadow army, stealth army to take over with airdrops of weapons directly to them, Benghazi, all of it. And again, you heard it here first. And they're going to attack shopping malls, and they're going to attack schools, and they're going to attack children's facilities. You watch Jewish schools. Bet your money. Because I know how to analyze things, and I talk to the top experts. 9/11 was staged with Saudi Arabia and criminals in our government and was not a real organization. ISIS just blew up an Egyptian ship yesterday. They just took over Egypt for a year and killed tens of thousands of people. And our government supported it, and CNN got up there with Anderson Cooper, who is Central Intelligence Agency, on record, and said it was a wonderful thing that was happening. 6 months into the burning Christians upside down and crucifying everyone, our news, I would sit there and watch Anderson Cooper praise it, and they praise the Libya takeover, and they praise the Syria situation. And so they pre-deployed a bunch of U.S. weapons in warehouses and had them resupply into Iraq, let them come in their convoys, didn't take any of them out. Let them behave in whatever type of activity they wanted. And now their operatives who are allowed to be recruited online. I mean, I told you, I've seen ISIS stuff in demonstrations in Austin. I've seen it at the White House. I've seen it. My reporters have seen it in Ferguson. I told you this is real. And I'm not pushing the narrative, oh, my gosh, there's terrorists under every table. Let's give our rights up. No, I said they will let them take over the Middle East and much of Africa. They'll then start attacking Europe, the United States, and the UK. And then the answer will be take our rights away and have checkpoints to go in the mall and more TSA on the streets to counter a threat they're bringing in. So, you're going to ban the name mother and father or husband and wife because it hurts somebody's feeling, or boy or girl. Those are mainstream articles, mainstream bills, and it's been done in many states. Totally unconstitutional. But we just, yes, you said this is how I'm supposed to talk, so I'll follow your orders. Now, I apologize. Paul Watson's on the line with us. I want to get his breakdown on all of this. But I am calling for all Muslims, converts, you name it, to be deported to the radical extremist third world, old world, hellhole dungeon of their choice. Recently colonized hellholes like Libya or areas of Syria. You want to go be slaves? You want to go hang out with people that openly say pedophilia is okay? And I mean, that's what these radical Islamists are really of. A demonic group of people. If that's where you want, you will be deported and your symbols are banned. Now, that's the logic. Ban the Confederate flag, ban mother and father, ban Mount Rushmore, ban the American flag. It's hurtful. Well, this symbol now in the hands of radicals is hurtful to me and the non-radical Muslims being killed by it all over the world, having their non-radical areas taken over. The Kurds, I mean, there's a bunch of subgroups that are not radical and don't have a history of hurting people and have a history of work. And those are the areas, Iraq, Syria, those are the areas taken down. Those are the areas annihilated. We're going to go to Paul Watson briefly. We have free shipping at InfoWarsStore.com and InfoWarsLife.com throughout the month of July. That's a huge discount. Super Male Vitality, Super Female Vitality, and X2, I believe, will all be sold out by Monday or Tuesday. And it'll be months until we get more X2, probably only a few weeks till Super Male, Super Female. These are super high quality, amazing formulas. You can read the third-party reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. We have links to third-party review sites right there. We are the only supplement company with these third-party review sites that have 5-star ratings across the board. It is unheard of. We have an overall 4.9. Oh, I'm sorry, it dropped 4.8. Most people would beg for a 4. Thousands of reviews, a 4.8. Go read the reviews, InfoWarsLife.com, for yourself. The Oxy powder's back in. The lung cleanse is back in. The Prostagard, the best prostate formula out there. Just amazing stuff. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. Okay, Paul Joseph Watson, I'm springing this on you. Paul Joseph Watson, I'm springing this on you. I'm springing this on everybody. But following their logic, I'm not being satirical. Following the logic of banning the word mother or father, because it's hurtful to someone, or boy or girl, got to be purple penguins. We'll put those articles on screen for new viewers or listeners. I'm not joking. Banning brown paper bags in Seattle because they might be hurtful. If anyone says it's hurtful, you can ban anything you want anytime. Well, undoubtedly, radical Islamists are pouring in. They're attacking all over Europe, all over the United States. They just killed 4 Marines and wounded 3 people. I mean, you can't have your cake and eat it, too. I mean, I have a CNN headline we'll put on screen. They've since changed it. They asked the question, why did he do it? And then they have this big, long article where they say, we don't know why he did it. Well, he was following jihad from ISIS and went and did what they ordered to attack targets. If you go to my Twitter, we'll do it this way, because they've since changed the headline. If you go to InfoWars.com, I'll go there and I'll go to our Twitter, and you go to some of the tweets, I'll put it up on screen over here, that I sent out last night. I tweeted this out. Yes. Why would he do this? Well, I'm telling you why he did it. And you go to my Twitter, because it was a soft target where guns weren't allowed. We're going to skip this network break to give Paul more time. I'm just so angry. He went and he picked a place where he could attack people that didn't have weapons to fight back against him. And I guess if from a dishonorable perspective, that's how you wage war. From an honorable perspective, that's not what I would do. But I wouldn't do that to begin with. I mean, what if somebody goes and shoots up a radical mosque? Oh, it'll be a white guy, an anti-Muslim. We've got a ban being anti-Islam. England has already done this, where you can't criticize Islam in any way or call it radical, or you're banned from traveling there, or you get arrested. Paul Joseph Watson from London, what do you think of my idea, my movement to, hey, let's ban everything. Let's ban the American flag. Let's ban Islam. Let's ban Christianity. Let's just all wear gray uniforms and not even speak. Should we launch this movement, Paul Joseph Watson?
Well, within a couple of days, Salon.com will probably write an article saying that you're going to lead to Muslims being murdered. Like they said that your anti-PC rants would mean that gay people would start being killed. But it's interesting, you know, Alex, because I put out a video after those ISIS attacks a few weeks ago in Tunisia and France and Kuwait, basically drawing attention to the parts in the Quran where it directly orders them to kill people, you know, smite them at their necks, kill the unbelievers, which is in the Quran, which is why these people are doing this, these horrific acts over and over again. That's the foundation of their motivation. And yet Obama's scared to even say the term Islamic extremism. David Cameron, every time there's an attack, says, let's just not call it Islamic. That's their primary concern. But it's funny because after I made that video talking about these violent passages in the Quran, somebody responded to it, this Muslim on YouTube. First, he said, there are no violent passages in the Quran. That's nonsense. And then he said, stop entering into affairs of Muslims. Otherwise, you will be killed. That's a direct quote. So radical Islam and Islam itself, the Quran, is not violent, but don't say that it is violent, otherwise we'll kill you. And then I put that on Facebook and got accused of being intolerant. I'm the one getting the death threat, but I'm also intolerant, if you can work that one out. So then we move on to the shooting yesterday. After the Charleston massacre, Salon.com came out and said, quote, white America must answer for the Charleston church massacre, which is somewhat different from what they said after the Boston bombings, which was, quote, Muslims don't need to apologize for the Tsarnaevs. And again, Rachel Maddow, she came out after Charleston and blamed conservatives, the GOP, this subgroup, for inspiring the Charleston shooting. Yesterday on her show last night, she slammed the ignorant scramble for answers after the Chattanooga attack. So apparently, attempting to get answers about the motives of the killer is only ignorant if he's not white. This is the politically correct insanity that we see time and time again after these shootings. There was a CNN guest last night. After they had announced and confirmed the shooter's name as Mohammed Youssef Abdulaziz, they confirmed that he was called Mohammed Youssef. This CNN analyst gets up and says, well, we don't even know if he's Muslim. How can we even start to speculate about his motives? The guy's called Mohammed Youssef, and he's saying he doesn't even know if he's Muslim. So again, you compare that to the frothing reaction to the Charleston massacre, the rampage against Confederate flags, that censorious attitude that has dominated the past several weeks, to this, where today, Salon.com's front page, they're not even talking about the shooting yesterday. They're attacking Bill O'Reilly. You have to scroll way down the page before you even find
And they're not even talking about 5-6 days into it, Planned Parenthood subdirector creamily talking about selling body parts and trying to chop the babies up in larger pieces to keep the organs deliciously fresh for sale. This ghoulish display from Hellraiser is no big deal. I have an idea. How about all the folks that we're tolerant of and quite frankly don't care what what they're doing in their bedroom. Rachel Maddow and all the Twinkies and everybody over at Salon, how about they dress up and prance around and try to go find some wine bars in areas of Syria where they're murdering and raping all the Christians? How about they go to areas of Iraq where they're murdering and raping the Turkish women and the Kurdish women? How about they go live in hell that they're trying to export over here because they have such a beef with what made America great? The truth is, these are mentally ill people that want to just urinate all over what's going on in America, and they have even no idea the hell pits that they're promoting as sexy. I mean, the left thinks hookahs and radical Islam is the sexiest thing since sliced bread, when they would grab one of these spoiled, rotten feminists taken care of by their rich daddy. You know, growing up driving brand new Mercedes Benz, they would take you and rape you for 6 months and make you a slave before they walk you outside and blow your filthy head off. And then you sit here and get mad at the West and the men that made you the freest women in the world. And how dare you come between men and women and our relationships and our families? You will never break the bond of family. You will never destroy humanity, you scum. You've done a good job, but humanity's waking up. I mean, these people are demons, Paul. They are the scum of the earth. Go ahead.
And, you know, a lot of their sacred cows about radical Islam are completely collapsing. And again, we've opposed the wars in the Middle East. That's why a lot of people on the right who are making these points attacking political correctness don't really have much credibility, because they supported the wars that created these radical Islamists in the first place. We oppose those wars. So we're saying that those were bad. The attack on Iraq, you know, George Bush said God told him to attack. That's bad. But also being radicalized by violent passages in the Quran, which do exist, is bad. So another sacred cow is that these radical Islamists are from poor backgrounds, and their socioeconomic status is a primary motivational factor for why they carry out these attacks. Well, look at the home of the Chattanooga shooter. In England, it would be treated as a mansion. It's definitely upper middle class for America. Swimming pool, huge house. You know, he was an engineering graduate, came from a wealthy family. For all intents and purposes, was living the American dream. So he didn't come from this poor socioeconomic background. He wrote in his own blog, quote, "Life is short and bitter, and the opportunity to submit to Allah may pass you by." But again, we're told over and over again, this has nothing to do with Islam. We're told that radical Islam is supported by a tiny, tiny minority of Muslims. When, if you look at the actual polls, in the West, 16% of French citizens support ISIS. That was reported by Newsweek. And to put it into perspective, only about 27% of French citizens voted for President Hollande in the 2012 elections. Then you can look at Britain. 9% in a recent ICM poll said they were sympathetic with or supported ISIS. Only 17% of Brits voted for David Cameron in the election a couple of months ago. So when you've got those kind of figures, it's no longer a tiny infinitesimal minority. It's a significant number of people that support these acts of terror, which is why we get death threats from their supporters on a routine basis.
And they'll say, "How dare you say we're violent? We're going to kill you."
Yeah, that's what one of them said to me yesterday. It's totally insane. But again, you know, white people have to apologize when one nutcase goes postal in a church. But God forbid, don't even suggest that there might be some violent passages in the Quran when these Islamists are killing people over and over again.
Well, Paul, we need to really make this point and force the issue and say, look, if you want to ban the term mother and father because it's hurtful, and you want to ban Confederate flags because one guy had one on when he did something, then let's just ban Islam. I mean, that makes a lot more sense than what they're calling for.
Well, there was actually a guy in London a couple of days, or in fact the day before the 10th anniversary of 7/7, who was literally stood across the street from the Houses of Parliament waving a huge ISIS flag, and then he in fact wore it and started walking down the street. The police did absolutely nothing. You compare that to the Confederate flag flap. Now people are literally getting invaded in their homes and guns pointed at them for flying the Confederate flag on their own property. So again, there's a huge disconnect. There's a huge hypocrisy between what's politically correct and what's hate speech, with people now even calling for Washington, D.C. to be renamed Black City because Washington owns slaves. You know, you saw the Mark Dice video the other day. Destroy Mount Rushmore. Obama supporters fully advocated that. They want to dig up Confederate generals.
Paul, we're going to go to break and come back for five more minutes with you. Then we've got Peter Schiff on the economy, world events with a 30-minute update, and more calls and news. And then we have another extremely informative guest joining us, Chuck Baldwin, who has said don't take down the Confederate flag. We'll get his take on that and this latest event and your phone call. Stay with us. Our Ahmed Yosef Abdulaziz, corporate-controlled media, is still saying, was it a terror attack? Was he a radicalized Muslim? He'd become increasingly interested in Islam. He was a Muslim from Kuwait, born there, a devout Muslim, listening to what he believed God was, you know, telling him in the Quran to carry out this attack. Now, brown paper bags are banned in Seattle and in city government because they're hurtful. I think we should ban Islam because a percentage of Islam is radical and terroristic. And we should deport all the Islamists. Like, actually, I don't believe that. I don't think you blame a whole group for what one person does. But there comes a point where ideologies get completely taken over. Like the Nazi ideology was bad. Do we agree? Or Soviet ideology was bad. I mean, you'd say don't tolerate that. Now, I know the media will misdirect what I've done and take it out of context, but I'm doing this for the sake of debate. Following their logic, all Muslims should be deported or arrested. I mean, isn't that pretty much it, Paul?
The other issue is, you know, the mosque in Chattanooga where the shooter went to do his prayers, they canceled their Ramadan celebrations in honor of the dead Marines, and all credit to them. Unlike Obama, who before even making a statement or paying tribute to the dead Marines, issued a statement basically lecturing Americans on how they should respect Islam.
Now, obviously, I'm sorry. I should have led the show with that. I totally apologize. I want you to hold five more minutes of the next hour, then we'll get Schiff on. I want you to flesh this out. I forgot to even get into this, or go ahead and cover it now, and then I'll cover it with Schiff coming up. He did this on purpose. Describe what Obama did. The story's on InfoWars.com.
Well, for hours after the Chattanooga shooting, and it was hours, there was no comment whatsoever from the White House. And you can go on the White House Twitter and see the timeline on this. They released this huge statement, Barack and Michelle, basically lecturing Americans about how they need to respect Islam, before they even commented on the shooting or paid tribute to the Marines. And you can go and look in the response to the tweet by the White House. People were absolutely furious at this. Obviously, this
but
is
Paul,
not Obama
it's sick. This brand of Islam cuts the heads off gays. They would cut Obama's head off. Hillary's a lesbian. They'd chop her head off. I mean, it's insane. So we should respect people that are mad that he goes to bathhouses?
But if this statement was released in a vacuum, fine. But somebody had to make that decision. Obviously, it wasn't Obama, but somebody at the White House had to make that decision to release a statement about how great Islam is. I think it was literally an hour or less before they commented on the dead Marines. And you can go in the comments of this tweet, and people are apoplectic about this. I'm surprised it hasn't got more attention.
It's meant to rub it in. It's meant to break our will.
Yeah, it almost seems deliberate. I mean, it almost seems deliberate.
Oh, it is. It's deliberate.
Total insanity.
They're all about optics up there. This is a victory letter to the Islamicist saying, I am here. Good job. Run ops. Now bring in my boyfriend. You know, that's what this
is
about.
It's insane. And of course, the other aspect is, you know, you look at Garland, Texas, numerous responsible people with guns. You look at this military recruitment center, a gun-free zone. So again, they're not going to be able to exploit this for gun control propaganda simply because of that fact. But I mean, yeah, this story about Obama releasing this statement or the White House releasing it, from my family to yours, Eid Mubarak, basically celebrating the end of Ramadan, which has been characterized by Muslim terror attacks across the world with dozens and dozens of people dead. That's how they like to celebrate Ramadan.
Yeah, so the headline should be Obama celebrates shooting and terror attacks worldwide and ships being blown up with a celebration saying submit to the will.
It's almost that bad, and the reaction was so intense. I'm surprised this isn't a bigger scandal already.
Well, no. I mean, they'll probably have Salon call out. I mean, they've already called for me to be shut down on the air. They'll probably call for me to be taken to Saudi Arabia and beheaded. And then for my daughters to be delivered to Al-Qaeda for mutilation. I mean, that's what's liberal. Paul, and I'm not kidding. I mean, it's so liberal to, you know, have a bag over your head. Thank you, Paul. CNN asked, why would Mohammed Yousef Abdulaziz carry out this attack? Gee, because he was an ISIS follower and said he was doing it for Allah? CNN have the headline, all Muslims are to blame for this attack. Like you said, all white people are to blame for the Charleston shooting. I don't blame all Muslims for this, but our governments all over the West are bringing in groups of radical Muslims and then saying we've got to submit to all of their ways while separately submitting to the most radical homosexual agenda that is at loggerheads with the Muslims. It's a broken Tower of Babel is what they want. And they've now announced they're going to use the attacks for a new domestic homeland security group to go after extremists before they commit crimes. And then they admit, oh, we're not worried about Muslims. They're not even going to say this was a Muslim terror attack now. They're saying, was it connected to Muslims? Again, is a bear in the woods? I mean, it's just, is the sun yellow? I mean, you know, is Obama a traitor? I don't want to get called names. I better not say anything bad about radical Islam. And then the big story is up on Infowars.com. Obama honors Islam before dead Marines killed by Islamic terrorist. Americans furious. He waited hours and hours after it was known he was a radical Islamicist and the rest of it to issue a bizarre end of Ramadan statement praising Islam and saying that Americans need to be tolerant. I mean, this is bizarre. But it's all the clash of civilizations. And again, they say you can't have the name mother or father on government documents. It's hateful. Or boy or girl. You got to ban the Confederate flag. That had nothing to do with slavery, but whatever. Take down Mount Rushmore. Well, then, deport the Muslims. Ban their symbols. And I'm not saying do that. But this is the logic of where this is going. And I don't particularly like the host of Real Time, Bill Maher, on a lot of his gun issues and things. But where he is consistent as a liberal, being, hey, let's be libertarian. People can do what they want sexually, whatever. Live the way you want as long as you don't hurt somebody else. Then he goes, but radical Islam is taking over Islam and is super dangerous, and why won't we say it? All the rest of the left will not go there. They will not go there, and it's dangerous. I mean, radical Islamists are not compatible with the West. And when you get sworn in as a citizen, can you guys give me the oath of citizenship? Because I never had to take it because I was born here. Some of the best people out there are immigrants. Some of the hardest working, coolest people from all over the world. Every race, color, creed, religion. I know a lot of Muslims went to college and high school with were really nice people. Very, you know, friendly, smart, hardworking folks. But that's not who's taking over via Saudi Arabia. And then now, 15 years after the fake war on terror, there's hundreds of thousands of these jihadis they're recruiting in the middle of a global depression. Now, I had Dr. Jerome Corsi, who is a top financial analyst. He's a consultant of the largest banks in the world, not just a three-time number one New York Times bestseller. And he said we're going into a global depression, he believes, by the winter. And he's been coming on for a decade or more. He's never made bold predictions like that. So many other guests are saying this is it. Schiff has been very accurate in his previous predictions. I think he might have predicted some stock market problems a little early, but who could imagine it could keep getting this big? So I want to get into that with him till about 40 after. Then I'm going to give the number out and take your calls on the shooting and give you the latest on that front. But Peter Schiff is with Europac.com, and he manages billions successfully. He also is host of the Peter Schiff Show, a frequent guest on Fox, CNN, MSNBC, you name it, and this transmission. And he ran for the Senate in 2010. He was Ron Paul's chief presidential advisor on economics in his first campaign as well. And he's a proponent of the Austrian School of Economics, which I would just call the theory of economic reality. It's prima facie or on its face. Peter, I know you don't really get into politics a lot, but you're a smart guy. I want your take on, we can't say we're boys and girls, we're purple penguins. I'm not kidding, in public schools, because it's hurtful to be a boy or a girl for somebody that doesn't know what they are. And we're going to ban the Confederate flag and blow up Mount Rushmore and, you know, all this political correctness. But no one can criticize radical Islamists that have now had multiple attacks inside the U.S., blew up a ship yesterday in the Mediterranean, are just running wild, and Obama puts out a bizarre congratulation before he even says anything about the dead Marines. What is going on here in your view?
Well, you know, it's all about political correctness. It's about form over substance. I mean, we don't want to address the real issues or the real problems. So we want to talk in sound bites about things that, you know, make us feel good about ourselves or, you know, tug at the heartstrings. And so I think there's a political agenda here at work that's a lot stronger than the need for, national security or anything that would actually help the U.S. economy in the long run. It's more about making us feel good in the short run, and we can pretend everything is okay.
Now, I know you're down in Puerto Rico right now investigating. They're saying it's the next shoe to drop. Do you agree with that? And what's your take since we talked 2 weeks ago about what's happened since? China's degenerating. Things are getting worse. That's what you were predicting. Others were predicting. What do you see happening?
I don't know if it's a shoot and drop. I think it's a problem, and I think it's a look into our future, because Puerto Rico has borrowed a lot of money. We've encouraged that by enticing all the debt, by making it triple tax-free in the United States. You know, we made it tax-free to invest in the government, but not in the private sector. So what we did with Puerto Rico was we helped them grow the government, not the private sector, and that's to the detriment of Puerto Rico. Meanwhile, we enticed all their residents onto the welfare rolls. We made it very difficult for people to get jobs by subjecting them to a minimum wage that is effectively double what it is in the U.S. mainland. So we wiped out entry-level jobs. Only 40% of the population is employed.
Wow.
The rest live on welfare. So, you know, we've hurt this economy tremendously with all these liberal programs that are being prescribed for the United States. And look at how sick that medicine made Puerto Rico. Why would we want to do it here?
It's crazy. Where do you see all this going? What's your take on the China situation? A lot of predictions by smart people that this winter is going to be hellish on markets, bond markets, you name it. I mean, give us your analysis of that.
Well, most people are optimistic, I think, on the market, certainly the U.S. market. I don't share that. I don't think the market's going to collapse, though, because I don't think the Federal Reserve will allow it to collapse. I don't believe that the Federal Reserve is going to raise interest rates like everybody thinks. In fact, if you look at the testimony of Janet Yellen this week, she testified up on Capitol Hill, all the headlines were about how she's about to raise rates, how she reaffirms that the Fed's going to raise rates this year. That helped the dollar, that sent gold to a new low for the year. But if you actually look at what she said, she didn't say she was going to raise rates. All she said was that if the economy evolves the way they expect, which is a big if, because it never evolves the way they expect.
They've been saying that for 2 years. If it gets better, they're going to raise them.
Yeah, but they didn't even say they're going to raise them. All she said is, if the economy evolves as they expect, it may be appropriate to raise rates. Not that it will be appropriate, but that it might be. And even if it is appropriate to raise them, that doesn't mean the Fed will raise them. I mean, the Fed could say, well, it's appropriate, but we're not going to do it because we don't want to. I mean, it's been appropriate to raise rates for years, and they haven't done it. In fact, it wasn't appropriate to lower them to zero. This is not about propriety. This is about expedience. And I think the Fed will keep interest rates at zero regardless of what's appropriate.
Now, I always ask the questions when you come on, but what's on your radar screen economically? What's Peter Schiff looking at right now, both positive and negative?
Look, I just look in amazement at how many people can be fooled by this gigantic bubble. And it's almost as if the bigger the bubble, the fewer people can see it. Because in my mind, this is worse than the bubble that led to the financial crisis of 2008. It's certainly worse than the bubble that led to the dot-com debacle in 2000, 2001. Yet everybody is so sanguine. Everybody thinks the U.S. economy is in great shape. They think Janet Yellen did a great job, just like they thought Alan Greenspan did a great job. He did a disastrous job. We lived through the 2008 financial crisis. That was the payback for what the mistakes that Greenspan made, except it wasn't payback enough because Ben Bernanke and now Janet Yellen came in to delay the full day of reckoning. We still haven't really dealt with all the consequences because we've postponed them with more quantitative easing, more 0% interest rates. But I think the economic crisis that we're heading for, the currency crisis, is going to dwarf as far as the economic pain for average Americans and investors than anything that happened in 2000 or 2008.
Wow. What do you expect the politicians to do when that happens?
Blame capitalism, you know, blame a lack of regulation, blame the speculators. Who knows? They're going to point the finger everywhere but at themselves. But hopefully, because of talk shows like yours, enough information will get out there that more people will know to blame the government, to blame the bankers and the politicians for these problems, because capitalism didn't cause them. Had we had capitalism, we wouldn't have the problems. It's government interference with capitalism that is the cause of all these problems.
Now we're going to go to break and come back. I've got a bunch of economic questions I want to go over with you, but what are some of the other big things on your radar you're going to cover?
Well, look at the economic data that keeps coming out. Look at personal spending numbers that came out horrible this week. And again, we keep getting more and more bad economic data, and everybody just glosses over it as if it never even came out, or they just dismiss it, and they just assume it's going to get better. Based on what? Based on hope? Just based on Janet Yellen saying she thinks the economy is going to improve? I mean, who cares what she thinks? She's never been right. And even if she thought the economy was going to get worse, that's the last thing she'd do is admit it.
But she does look like a cave creature from that movie, The Descent. So she can get a job in Hollywood. I'm being sarcastic. When we come back, I also want to look at Greece and how they voted, but then it didn't matter. The government went ahead and handed over the resources. Sure, Greece is insolvent, but what about the big mega banks, too? Aren't they the biggest welfare heads out there? The GAO warns the next debt crisis could be a lot worse. Yeah, no kidding. It is worse. Inflation, real American wages went down in June. Google just had its biggest one-day rally ever, and it's the biggest in history for anybody. So it's just a bunch of confusion and craziness, but I go out there and see the real economy. It's in trouble. And then I see cash controls, capital controls, $50 billion in assets being handed over to basically Germany. And then I see the American people signed on to the big banks that are too big to fail. That's my concern, Peter Schiff from EuroPacificCapital.com. My concern is that what about all the corporate welfare? How do we stop that? Again, EuroPac.com is your website. How do we educate people about this alliance between crony capitalist and socialist lawmakers to domesticate us? Because it seems like when the next crisis comes, they're just going to bring us deeper into the same thing that got us here.
Yeah, you know, and some of the biggest recipients of the corporate welfare are the big donors to the Democrats. I mean, they make a big deal about how they, you know, want to redistribute wealth or how they want more equality, but they are giving a lot of money to politicians to prevent that from happening, at least when it comes to preserving some of their corporate welfare or some of their special tax breaks that most people don't get. I mean, what we have to do is take the power away from Washington so they can't dole out special treatment to their friends. They need to treat everybody equally. I'd like to abolish the income tax entirely and everybody will be on a level playing field. And let's just have a small government that operates based on excise taxes.
Sure. But,
you know, you just mentioned consumer prices and real income. And I noticed that we got the CPI today, which, of course, is the government's version, which is, you know, really doesn't tell the whole story. But even if you accept their numbers, June consumer prices were up 0.3%. And if you look at the annualized real wages, you alluded to that, real wage growth now is at the slowest it's been in 7 months. And it's not like it's been pretty fast during the past 7 months. But if Janet Yellen is looking for, you know, the economy to evolve the way she expects, that's not what's happening. In fact, even the housing starts numbers that came out today, the news is talking about, oh, you know, we beat the estimates. But if you actually look at the numbers, there was a drop in single family home construction. The only reason we had all these housing starts is because of apartments. And the reason that we're building so many apartments is because the renters are too poor to buy. But you have all this cheap money sloshing around Wall Street looking for a return. And so they're building all these rental units. But if the Fed actually raised interest rates, you'd see a collapse in that market. And I think they're overbuilding the rental market because the bad news is not only can't people afford to buy, they can't even afford to rent.
And so they bring more unskilled third world labor in who then immediately get signed up for welfare. That just sounds like a disastrous combination.
Yep. And, you know, we had other numbers out. We had the Philly Fed. You know, they were all excited because there was a bounce in June. Well, it plunged back down in July. And the employment component of the Philly Fed, that was the lowest it's been since January. Even the weekly unemployment claims that came out on Thursday, the moving average now is now the highest in 3 months. So everything seems to be going the other direction. Industrial production came out. I mean, it's year over year. We just got industrial production for June. It's the slowest increase year over year since February 2010. And auto production collapsed 5.5% in June, which is probably a good sign that that automobile bubble is popping. You know, we have a big bubble in subprime auto lending. And so that could be coming to an end as well. And if the Fed were to raise interest rates, it would only hasten the demise of that bubble.
Peter, if you were president, what would you do to try to restore our country to its greatness? I mean, I think Donald Trump's saying a lot of things that I agree with, but he's not giving a lot of specifics.
Yeah, well, I'd probably have to wake up from my dream because that's probably my only chance of being president is somehow if I dreamt it. But, you know, if there was any way I could be president, I'm assuming I'd have a sympathetic Congress in there with me, because anybody that would vote Peter Schiff president, I'm assuming they're voting for the right guys in Congress. So we could do a lot. In fact, even if I was president, somehow if you just stuck me in the Oval Office with the current Congress, there is a lot I could do with my veto pen. Probably the most important thing I would do is I would veto every single bill that Congress passed, including raising the debt ceiling and any attempt to get around that to try to force the government to cut spending. And I know President Obama has accomplished a lot to grow government through executive order. I would try to do whatever I could to shrink and abolish government agencies and departments through the same executive order. So I try to do a lot to disrupt the government and free up people.
Sure. I mean, we could also say if Rand Paul got elected and made you Treasury Secretary, what would you advise the president to do? So let's come back and walk through more of that, because it's these ideas set up as the solution that will be out there juxtaposed against the policy now that we know is making a tiny group ultra rich and making everybody else poor. We'll be back with Peter Schiff. Stay with us. Pastor Chuck Baldwin will be with us for about 30, 40 minutes in the next hour. We'll continue with calls as well. The toll-free number to join us on this live Friday edition is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. And I would imagine a lot of you want to talk about the shooting yesterday and the political correctness where the media, even though the guy's a Muslim, clearly did it as a jihad attack. They won't even say it was for Muslim extremist reasons, and Obama won't call it Muslim terrorism. I mean, if a Christian went in and blew stuff up saying they were a Christian, it'd be called Christian terrorism. But all whites were blamed by MSNBC, Salon, and others saying all whites are to blame. That was the headlines for the degenerate shooter. I am not to blame. How dare you? And I don't think Muslims should be blamed in general. Most Muslims in this country that I know and have run into and the studies I've seen just want to make money and be happy and live in a free country. And, you know, if they moved here and were sworn in as citizens, they read this oath that I'm going to be reading. So if you're not following your oath, you know, it means something. And, hey, you know, if you are a radical Muslim and want to live in a dirt floor deal and rape women and put bags on their heads and sexually mutilate people and, you know, blow up churches and stuff, go to one of your hell holes and do it. But see, our government blamed Iraq for 9/11, took them out, and now radicals have been put in, and the country's been divided in three effectively. So America was wrong to do that, and I apologize. I tried to stop it, so did Peter Schiff, so did Ron Paul. But still, I will say, as an American, I'm sorry to Iraq. But I will not sit here and watch our government fund ISIS running around committing stuff and then act like they don't know what's happening. And I am very angry right now, and we're going to be talking about that Peter Schiff is our guest. McDonald's franchises have never been this depressed. And again, I see that as people voting with their dollars. Not that the economy's so bad people can't afford McDonald's. I think that's part of it, as Schiff has said. But the other part is people are trying to buy healthier food. By the way, we're not going to announce this till next hour. Our Facebook has been suspended. And then we made a few phone calls and noticed that other libertarian sites were suspended. Not expelled, not shut down. But if you get three of them in a year, they shut you down. They've been giving them to us for just nothing. And we think it's clearly for criticizing the shooter. But we're trying to ferret it out right now and doing some testing. But I'm not going to apologize for saying the guy was wrong to shoot the four Marines. I know I'm racist and bad. It's like a liberal sacrament to blow a Marine's head off when they're unarmed. I get it. You're the good guys. I'm the bad guy and everything. But you're sick freaks. And Zuckerberg's a sick freak. Peter Schiff, Europac.net. Peter, you got about 7 minutes left. I know you got to go. Appreciate you coming on. I can sit here and ask my economic questions all day. The Greece situation, any more on that? What else are you looking at? And then what's some good news?
Well, before I even mention Greece, as long as you're talking about McDonald's and restaurant sales, you know, on the retail sales numbers that came out this week, we actually had a drop in restaurant and bar sales by 0.2%. That's the biggest decline since January of 2014. And, you know, the problem is, you know, college grads need a vibrant restaurant business because that's where they get their jobs. You know, you graduate from college and then you can land a job at McDonald's. And so that's going to be problematic for our, you know, our college grads. But as far as Greece is concerned, unfortunately, right, Greece is going to make a deal with the devil. They're going to stay in the Eurozone, but they're going to borrow even more money to do it. So the Greek people are going to go deeper into debt because the Greek government didn't want to deal with the consequences of abandoning socialism. You see, they need Europe's money to continue to make payments to Greek voters, even if they have to deliver some bad news and tell you know, Greek pensioners and government workers that they're going to have to take some cuts. They would have to take much bigger cuts if they actually left the Eurozone. But that would actually be a good thing, because what we need is less government in Greece and more freedom. Instead, they're going to agree to higher taxes. They're going to continue to keep people on the dole. And ultimately, there's going to be some kind of violent revolution in Greece, because this is not going to work. What's going on?
Is this about Western governments and the robber baron class living for the day and just robbing the bank, trying to build their armored redoubt, you know, in some faraway place as they're now doing, headed for the exits, that there really isn't a big conspiracy? They kind of had a big global government talk to act like they had an exit plan, but really their exit plan is the collapse of civilization with all the stealing and the socialism and the redistribution, because they never back off the socialism or the corporate welfare. They seem to only double down. And if you study history, I mean, I was reading yesterday in the London Telegraph and also in several other papers, they say Rome is a rotting, festering rat hole now. Just 10 years ago, it was nice. Other mega cities are falling apart. I was back in New York recently. It looked like a third world country. It was looked nice 10 years ago. I go to L.A. It looks scary, except in certain areas. I go to Dallas. I grew up there. It looks scary. What is going on?
Yeah, well, first, you know, it was a mistake for the European countries to have come together in a union. It was, you know, because of politicians that wanted more power that they sold it to the people. But it wasn't a good deal. Not because it's preventing Greece from printing more money, right? The problem is it's putting all these countries together is just growing the government. And I know Germany couldn't afford to allow the moral hazard of forgiving the Greek debt. So they have to keep them in there just so they can send a message to everybody else. But, you know, it was a mistake now looking back for our states to have come together. You know, the 12 initial colonies, you know, given where we are today, we would be better off had they never formed a central government and had they stayed independent states. Maybe had we operated under the Articles of Confederation instead of the Constitution, because what the original framers intended was a very small federal government with very little power that would only tax us in times of war.
And it would only deal with disputes between the states.
Yeah, and now we have an all-powerful federal government. I think most states would be better off seceding from the Union. The average state would be better off if he wasn't part of the United States, if it was a separate country and it can operate with a lot less money. But now we're stuck together in this very imperfect union.
Well, I agree with you. And, you know, I've said we could have the states secede under the Declaration of Independence and then reform with a real limited federal government.
Because we saw what happened last time. They tried that. There were some southern states that tried that. And we had, you know, the Civil War. So it didn't work out so well. And then as a result of the Civil War, we got paper money. We got the income tax. We got all kinds of other bad things.
But see, you're a smart guy. You know the real history of that. It had nothing to do with slavery until the end. And 2% of the South had slaves. It's a total red herring. It was all about Western expansion, all about tariffs in the North on Southern goods. And then they just tell the public, no, it was about hating black people. When in truth, that's why Robert E. Lee was the top general in the North, the commandant of West Point. They wanted him to be the head of the Northern forces. And he said, I don't want to do this, but this is illegal what you're doing. I have to go join the South. And Robert E. Lee hated slavery.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I mean, slavery was bad, no question about it. At least the one good thing that came out of the Civil War was that it ended. Of
course,
it would have ended anyway, eventually. But, you know, there was more racism in the North than there was in the South. You know, but the reality was that Lincoln didn't free the slaves until the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863. We were 2 years into the war. And the reason he did that was because France was threatening to come to the aid of the South. And so Lincoln had to make it about slavery rather than about something else. So it ended up that we got to free the slaves. But that's not why the war started.
But again, you read books, you read history, which makes you a racist. Yeah. I'm being sarcastic because with the new political correctness, they just trump our facts with just claiming we're racist, we're right wing, we're hateful. I mean, I don't think you call yourself right wing. What do you call yourself? Just a free market guy.
Yeah, look, I would have loved it if Thomas Jefferson had had his way and the original Declaration of Independence emancipated the slaves, but we wouldn't have had the document. They had to cave in. And you know, just because I understand the true history of the Civil War doesn't mean I'm pro-slavery.
No, exactly.
Horrible. And the fact is, it's bad economics. That's why it was dying out all over the world. There's only, I think, maybe one other nation in the world that fought a war to end slavery. Every place else that had it, you know, it went away on its own. And it would have gone away. It might have taken another 20 years. But, you know, we wouldn't have had Jim Crow. We wouldn't have had a lot of the problems and the animosity that existed following that Civil War. And so I think ultimately the descendants of slaves would have been much better off had we not fought that war. They would be free today. But I think and the nation would have, we would have saved millions of lives. The economic damage that resulted from that war was horrific. And the government used the war to usurp all sorts of powers. I mean, I think if we never fought that Civil War, we wouldn't have the income tax today. We might not have the Federal Reserve. We might still be on a gold standard. And we wouldn't have any slaves, so we'd all be a lot freer.
Well, plus, if they do the background, most Americans that came here of any color, their ancestors came here after the Civil War. Most white people have no connection to slavery. And so it's just asinine.
Well, of course not. And of course, very few whites owned slaves. And in fact, there were even some blacks that owned slaves. So, you know, it wasn't like, you know, it was only whites. But look, I don't want, look, it was a terrible thing. Slavery is the worst thing.
No, I totally agree. The issue is we're here watching the country in deep trouble. And this is still the biggest issue out there that they use as a diversion.
It is a diversion. And you look, I'm Jewish. I mean, you know, there were Jews that were enslaved at 1.2. But I'm not, you know, I'm not owed anything as a result of it. We have real economic problems and we have modern slavery.
So the Babylonians and the Egyptians don't owe you anything.
No, we're all slaves to the U.S. government. The way I look at it, this is one big giant plantation and the government takes half of everything I earn and then they try to control everything that I do. You know, the slave owner only got 10% of his slave's production. So the U.S. government gets a lot more from me economically than any plantation owner got out of its slaves.
That's right.
And so we have to get rid of these chains. You know, we have to free ourselves, emancipate ourselves from this current system. And we have to go back to what the founders envisioned, not just for us, but for all the people of the United States, black, white,
sure,
immigrant, whoever it is. We all need to be free.
I agree. Peter Schiff, powerful point. In 60 seconds closing, how do we launch a peaceful global slave revolt worldwide to stand up and say, we're paying 60, 70% in France, 80, 90% to a bunch of corrupt government bureaucrats that are above the law and tax exempt in most cases. That's the most incredible part about it is that we are truly slaves. How do we become free again, Peter Schiff?
You know, I don't know. I mean, my dad tried it. You know, he's 87 years old and he's still in jail because he stood up for the Constitution and wasn't paying.
By the way, your dad is in prison for writing a book.
writing books and advocating that people follow the law the way he sees it and not pay taxes. So you can't just stop paying unless you're willing to risk going to jail like my father. I mean, look, we can vote. We can vote for Rand Paul. You know, we can vote for people who profess to support the Constitution and stand for liberties. But it is very difficult. And, you know, we've got an army of Americans now who are beholden to the federal government. They divvy up the loot that the government steals, sure, to outvote us. So it's very difficult. You know, we are enslaved by democracy. You never, and the founding fathers, you know, also didn't like democracy. Sure. They tried to save us from democracy by creating a republic, but the republic has collapsed and we're living under the tyranny of democracy.
Well, let me show a Forbes article about your dad, Irwin Schiff, who I was pretty good friends with, interviewed him in person probably 15 times, spoke on the lecture circuit with him, really cool guy. Forbes headline, Ninth Circuit rules 85-year-old tax protester should stay in jail. I followed your father's case closely, obviously not as much as you, but I remember it being in the Las Vegas Review-Journal. With a straight face, they reported that the judge said, okay, you're not going to go to prison. Don't put your book out anymore.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Your dad said, no, you put the book out and went to prison, and he's been in there how long? I mean, he is a political prisoner. I mean, dad's a hero.
His book, I think, other than Lolita, it was like the only book that the government's ever banned, his book, The Federal Mafia. You know, if you haven't read his economic books, you know, they really influenced me. I still have copies, you know, The Biggest Con, Kingdom of Malts. I mean, if anyone goes to, you know, my shiftradio.com, I have a bookstore there. You can order these books. I don't have that many left, but they're you know, I got them in my garage. But, you know, he really influenced my economic way of thinking.
Wow, so, I didn't know you were selling these banned books. How evil. Let's spend a minute or two on your dad, then I'll let you go. Because I never want to bring your dad up because I know it's private. I should have asked you, but you brought him up. What a cool guy. How much energy he's got. How is he doing after a decade in prison?
Look, he's still alive. Most of his friends aren't. You know, none of his sisters are still alive. You know, there's a lot of people that haven't made it to 87. And, you know, he's relatively healthy. I think he'd be in better shape if he was in a real hospital and not a government prison. But he only has a couple years left in his sentence. So hopefully he'll stay healthy long enough to get out so he can see his grandchildren and spend some time, you know, with his family, you know, before, you know, he meets his maker. But, you know, he really believed in what he did. And it's unfortunate, but, you know, the principles that he stood for, they're vibrant. It's still alive in a lot of people's minds. And, you know, a lot of the forecasts that he made in his book, The Biggest Con, that's the one I still sell, that he wrote in 1972, 1973. All this stuff is coming true. You know, his book was very prescient, but it was obviously very early, because a lot of the things that he forecasts are happening now. Much of this stuff happened later in the 1970s.
Yeah, your dad battled the Federal Reserve, the New World Order, everything. And he did it for, gosh, like, your dad's been around 40 years and longer doing this. And he's somebody we don't talk about in prison right now. I remember reading the thing. Judge sentences him to long term for republishing book. I mean, that is just, but meanwhile, people can run around at shopping malls with ISIS flags. Incredible. Peter Schiff, Europac.net. Look forward to talking to you again in 2 weeks, sir. And say hi to your dad next time you talk to him.
I will.
All right, thank you. Yeah, I mean, I just forget his dad is a real live political prisoner, ladies and gentlemen. A real live political prisoner. I mean, go research it. They tried to put, he was here in studio 2 weeks ago, or a week and a half ago, they tried to put Joe Bannister, highly decorated, 7 years as a Treasury agent, armed Treasury agent, and he heard a radio show saying the Federal Reserve's private, the IRS never got ratified, the income tax, he didn't believe it. He set out to disprove it for 2 years, found out it was true, went to his superiors, and they said, I'm going to have to resign if you can't tell me this isn't true. And they said, listen, the fact that you even looked into this, resign. And then now his buddies call him and apologize, and now all know it's true. But they tried to put him in jail not once, but twice in the last 5 years. And he got jury trials. And the juries would go out and tell the news. It's like they proved his case. And all he was doing was giving speeches as a CPA. Look how Lois Lerner's trying to put everybody in prison. And she didn't get in trouble. I mean, folks, this is Nazi or Soviet level. I mean, this is chilling. I just got chills, so I'm saying chilling. I mean, my body just chills because I know I'm up to bat here. I don't like it. I can really feel the wings of the New World Order flapping around me. It's only because we're so public that we're even still here. So please pray for us. I'm going to go to break and come back and go to Garrett, Sherry, Dion, Steve, and others. I'm going to go to your calls. We're going to get Chuck Baldwin on at 15 after. So I got the next segment and then two more little segments to get through these callers. Briefly, I've already done almost another hour of broadcast and have not plugged anything. We are funded by you. We have the best products at very low prices. Cook stoves, high quality, non-GMO, storable foods. We have amazing nutraceuticals, free shipping the month of July. And it's your support, it's your purchases that make it all possible. You want to thank me all the time on the street. It's very humbling. I want to thank you. We couldn't have done any of this without you. So we bring you the best products, the lowest prices. Shop with the good guys, InfoWarsStore.com. You know, I said I'd go to your phone calls, but usually 2 hours into the show, being so serious, I start looking further afield to psychological distractions. Coming up, I want to give the United States Oath of Allegiance that you have to give when you become a citizen. And a lot of these people attacking us are not citizens, and it's because they hate this country. And I don't know why they'd want to come here to be in a liberal country. And by liberal, I mean just a lot of freedom. That's what real liberalism is. And then they want to get angry about it. Just, you know, I'm sorry, not going to work. So I want to go to your calls just briefly because I mentioned it. We do have a lot of specials running right now on InfoWarsStore.com. 25% off the Molon Labe belt buckle products that are almost sold out. 10% off all the t-shirts made in America and elsewhere. We have a whole Made in America division at InfoWarsStore.com. And then at InfoWarsLife.com, a subdivision of InfoWarsStore.com, you can find all the great nutraceuticals with free shipping as well. And we're not jacking up the prices like a lot of folks would do. As Super Male Vitality is set to sell out by early next week, Super Female's got about 2 weeks left. And X2 will be sold out, we think, by Monday or Tuesday. And then hopefully we'll be able to get more manufactured and get it in. But if you do want it or want to stockpile it, it's the good halogen, fills up the thyroid, other glands, so the bad halogens can't get in there. It's been a major life changer. You can read the rave reviews at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. There's a lot of other great nutraceutical products there as well, so be sure and check them out. Five-star reviews, unheard of. And so thank you all for your support in many ways. Garrett in Texas, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yes, Alex. I actually have a couple of questions for you if you'd like to hit a few points.
But yeah, I'm not screening your call. You're on the air right now.
Okay, excellent. Well, number one, I wanted to talk about the economy, and it seems like the major transition into the more unionized government, it seems like it's going to go with North American first, as we predicted, although we already know that NAFTA is in place, so it's kind of softly in place. It seems like, to me, the easiest way for it to be done, when I talk to my parents, people in the in society, I'm a waiter, so I talk to a lot of people from all different kinds of backgrounds. It seems to me that it's going to be very easy for them to transition over to it and accept it if the dollar devaluates and really all the money in their bank accounts and all their retirement, especially old folks who have have to rely on the government for their retirement and other sources, when all of that's worth nothing, and the answer is, we'll switch over to this new currency, and that's the only way you're going to get your money back in your
Yeah, that's what they're going to do, account. Crash the global economy in steps, bring in the new global currency. You'll still have it localized, but it'll be pegged to the new global SDR. That is one of the main plans they're kicking around. I'm not saying that's what's going to happen, but that's openly being debated by some very wicked, cold-blooded scumbags.
Right, and so that seems like the main facet as far as people not actually being able to fight against that because they've put so much into it already. Now, I want to tie into the Iran deal real quick, if you'll let me. It seems to me, and I got this idea actually from one of the guests already on your show, and I wanted to kind of bring it back.
Hold on, I'll come back to you in 70 seconds, then we'll go to Dion, Steve, Sherry, and others, and I'm going to take all these calls. So, the mayor of Kansas City came out and celebrated the fact that the city is majority-minority. It's celebrated everywhere that whites are about to be the minority, right as the left energizes minorities with racial hatred. And the most popular name in London, or in England, period, is now Muhammad, because Europeans don't have children. And then the liberals go, please sexually mutilate me, put a bag on my head, radical Muslims, I love you, basically. Don't criticize it. It's an honor to be shot by a radical Islamicist, and Alex Jones is evil. People want to be poor in a collapsed society because they've had it good so long, they just lust to destroy themselves. It's self-destructiveness. Okay, Garrett, I got to get to other callers. Finish your other points real quick. You had one about Iran.
Okay, so Iran, it seems to me that basically he made that deal just to kind of put on paper the, hey, if you do this, then we have the excuse to attack. And that's going to give Israel the excuse to attack Iran. He knows they're going to create nuclear weapons. He knows that they probably already have a few, if not more than that, that this is going to be the, hey, if you do this, this gives us the excuse to attack in the moral high ground for the world. Now, crossing over, it seems that they're escalating not in force into the American people that you normally see in movies that concern things like this. But it seems to me that they're forcing more and escalating more in the propaganda aspect. That's why it's getting so crazy. Just keep us paranoid and keep us going crazy over and fighting with the propaganda. While in the meantime, the economy is going to implode. They're using all the stuff in the Middle East to confine that region, to get rid of anybody who could have been a threat, any of the dictators over there that could have actually fought back. Then they're going to put them all on the central banking system, unionize that area. That's why they're imploding the EU, and it's all tied together. I'll let you get to
that. Sure, they're going to merge the Middle East with the EU. Yeah, that's part of the plan. Good points, Garrett. Good to hear from you. Dion in Illinois, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex. Have you read the book A Day of Wrath?
No.
It's a book about coordinated ISIS attacks in the United States that occur in American highways and American schools.
Well, why are you being racist against it? It's a sacrament of holy liberalness to have a radical Muslim blow your head off. Are you white? You deserve it.
Well, I'm concerned because of what happened in Tennessee, so I'm thinking this might be a beacon for coordinated attack, like in schools or highways. There's going to be a big one coming.
Well, yeah, and George Soros is trying to finance a race war. Absolutely. Of course, I was being sarcastic, you know, saying anybody deserves it. It's just totally sick. I mean, are you seeing the left today paper over this and say it wasn't terrorism? I mean, it's just, they're just completely sick.
Yeah, the local newspaper by me, they're calling it a gunman when we know it was domestic terrorism.
And they're going to, but they are setting up a domestic terrorism outfit, but that's only for patriots.
I agree with you, Alex. They're not labeling the terrorists domestic terrorists. They're labeling the patriots domestic terrorists.
That's the plan, Dion. Good to hear from you. Steve, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. He said there was another Steve. Yeah, good afternoon, Alex. I called in to talk about war, which you were talking about yesterday, and specifically psychological warfare. But before that, I just wanted to say, I think I've come up with a perfect solution to your dilemma with being demonized by the media and always attacked and misrepresented. And you were talking about banning. Well, I'd suggest that we ban the name Alex Jones and change your name to what they want it to be, which is Alexa the Matrix Jonestown. That way you'll fall right in line with them. You know, they say you're promoting false information and
tell you what, you know, stay there. Yeah, no, I mean, I could have an alternate character. I could be Alexis Jones, like the other guys, Queenie Jenner or whatever her name is, its name is, and then I could do that. Things would be a heck of a lot easier if this was a dictatorship, just so long as I'm the dictator. That was George W. Bush in 2003, and Obama basically has made the same statement two times that we know of. Well, here's the InfoWars graphic made by Kurt Nemo, I believe, on the front page of InfoWars.com with an image of Obama at the lectern. And it says, we have to get a debate going about the fact we're pretty much a dictatorship now. Even mainline constitutionalist lawyers and scholars on both sides say that. Alex Jones. I completed my quote because I remember what I actually said. I think Kurt edited it for brevity. But that's a fact. I mean, we're pretty much a dictatorship now. And Europe, even mainline articles are going, is going into dictatorial modes. And it's really scary because with that comes economic degradation and war. Corrupt governments always act the same. Look at this headline. Rome is on the verge of collapse and needs urgent repair, leaders warn. This is globalism. Now, the headlines are on Infowars.com. I'd ask you to send both these articles out to everybody you know. One of them is Alex Jones calls for deportation of all Muslims. The other is Obama honors Islam before dead Marines killed by Islamic terrorists. Americans furious. That's a good headline by Paul, but it's worse than that. Hours after we knew it was a radical Islamicist, Obama lectured Americans to be tolerant of Islam, he means radical, and didn't speak about the Marines. I mean, this is the rubbing it in that you're going to take it, you're going to take it, you're going to be overwritten, you're going to accept it. Because it's about mob rule. Now, I want to race through some calls and finish up because we're going to have Chuck Baldwin on here in about 4 or 5 minutes for the balance of the hour. Pastor Chuck Baldwin, former head of the Constitution Party, and he writes a syndicated column, good friend of mine. I wanted to get his take on his editorial he wrote about why we should raise the Confederate flag, and he's got some good points about that, just illustrating that it's not about what they say it is, and a challenge to political correctness, but then we're going to shift gears into the shooting and radical Islam. I know there are a lot of Muslims that aren't radical, but what's driving Islam today is a conquering spirit, colonialism. Europe was almost colonized and taken over. Spain was. Spaniards were blonde-haired, blue-eyed, Germanic country in Caesar's day. Looked like the Russell Crowe in Gladiator. There are people say, that guy didn't look like a Spaniard. Well, that's what Spaniards actually look like. That was taken over by North Africans. And now the head of EU security last week said we should accept political Islam and let it take over. And she's not even a Muslim. So there's this weird leftist plan. Hey, we'll just merge with radical Islam in the Middle East. I mean, this is just, well, Napoleon converted to Islam for a while. This has been going on for a while to conquer and take stuff over. The new pope will not talk about Planned Parenthood openly selling baby parts. I mean, where's the new pope on baby parts? He won't even be against abortion now. He wants world government. I mean, this is true apostasy. And I'm no preacher, but it's sick. And everybody's showing who they really are now. So I'm going to take a few calls, and I'll go back to more calls after. We've been talking to Chuck some. But I wanted to finish up with Steve in Florida. He was saying I should be politically correct and change my name to Alexis Jenner Jones. Now, what are you getting at here, Steve?
Well, you know, you just got to go with the flow, Alex. You can't make waves because otherwise you're criticized. And, you know, God forbid that that should be the case because you're standing up for what's right and true, you know. But the main reason I called in, you were talking about warfare yesterday. And you know that we're continually subjected to psych warfare. And I don't know if you've ever seen this. You probably are aware. There's a woman named Catherine Pollard Griggs, Kay Griggs. She was the wife of Colonel George Griggs, who was the head of special operations at NATO.
Yeah, I've never sat through all 6 hours or whatever it is. But her claiming that there was weird homosexual cult in the military, that's how they control people high up. I don't know about the Marines, but I know Congress, the Catholic Church, a lot of Protestant leaders, the Republican leadership, Democrats to a certain extent as well. The Democrats tend to be into like weird occult heterosexual orgies. Republicans, it's like occultism and homosexual activity. But the Democrats are into that big time as well. They're just not closeted. And I'm not saying every gay person or homosexual is involved in the occult. I'm just saying what this group does. And it's just so bizarre. Skull and bones. I mean, they get in big pools of feces and urinate on each other. I mean, that's even in the movie The Good Shepherd, produced and directed by Robert De Niro, who gave speeches and said, no, this is based on what really goes on. And folks have broken in repeatedly. We know what goes on. It's a Germanic death cult. People then say, oh, Alex says a Germanic death cult runs the world. No, I didn't. I've interviewed, you know, Tony Sutton and other people that weren't got the documents, the daughter of a famous Skull and Bonesman, Charlotte Iserby. That's what it is a Germanic death cult. So it's just a bunch of weirdo wizard death cults into every form of weirdness you can imagine, and they're taking stuff over. Steve, I appreciate your call. I'm going to go back to Matt in Tennessee, Sherry in Texas. Omega in Indiana, Steve in Florida is up next. When we go to calls, because Pastor Chuck Baldwin's a talk show host in his own right, so he can certainly ride shotgun with us after we've talked to him a while and take your questions and comments to both of us, so we'll get to your calls. But joining us now is Pastor Chuck Baldwin. Chuck Baldwin Live is his website. We can put his article up on screen that we posted at InfoWars last week. Paraphrasing, I forget the exact headline, but it was basically, you know, it's time to raise. There it is. The Confederate flag needs to be raised, not lowered. So we'll get him to break down what he's getting at from that perspective in a moment. But before we go there, I wanted to get his take on the Chattanooga situation and the fascist fake left media bending over backwards to say this isn't connected to the religion of peace, Islam. I've fired a major shot across the bow. They're banning the name father and mother and the names boy and girl and husband and wife in California and Oregon and other areas, and saying that the fact that heterosexuals exist is hurtful and that Christian churches need to be banned and that all whites are responsible for the wicked shooter at the church in Charleston, then we should say all of Islam's evil and get rid of all their symbols and deport all Muslims. Now, I'm actually not an Islamophobe. I was against those wars targeting non-radical countries. It was actually meant to radicalize, then turn the Middle East over to radicals in a secret deal with the globalists and Saudi Arabia. So I've been against their whole program of just total wickedness. But if we follow the logic of the fascistic left, and if Salon and others said that Charleston Church Massacre, the violence white America must answer for, if whites are collectively guilty and Christians are for every crime going on, well, then, Pastor, should we then say clearly we can say Islam is calling for violence, but I don't expect the left to pick that up. Why does the left, in your view, it's an undisputed love affair, have a love affair with radical Islam, and why is Obama overthrowing any non-radical country that's working with the West or trying to not cause problems and who lets Christians live in peace? Like Syria, Saudi Arabia, of course, is running that, running the attack on Egypt, running the attack on Libya, running the attack on Iraq, the Kurds. Why is the left targeting non-radical Muslims, and what's your view of the situation?
Well, first of all, Alex, thanks for letting me come on your show again. It's good to talk to you, as
Thank
always.
Thank you.
And I really appreciate what you're doing. I think your analogy that you just made, relative to the two shootings, and how that as a result of the first one, the Confederate flag has got to come down. They're digging up the remains of Nathan Bedford Forrest in Memphis, Tennessee, removing the monument there. They're, you know, making an effort to remove anything that is remotely considered Confederate throughout the United States, all as a result of the shooting that you referred to. And then at the same time, absolutely no response whatsoever in regards to the fact that this was obviously a radical Muslim extremist who had personal vendettas against the United States and its military. And yet there's no connection to that whatsoever, no fallout, no ramification. You know, there's no call in Congress to remove all things Islam, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Your analogy is perfect. I think we understand, and that was the point of my column, about the Confederate flag, was that this is not about the Confederate flag. This is not about, you know, the slavery or the war between the states. It's not about any of that. It's about expunging the principles upon which America was founded and upon which the Confederate States of America was founded, and that is the position of liberty and decentralized government. And that's the thing that's been lost in this whole debate relative to the Confederate flag and the Confederacy in general, is that the war was fought over the centralization of power. Lincoln was a unionist in the strictest form. In other words, he did not believe in a voluntary union. Jefferson and Washington, the founding fathers, believed that we were a voluntary union of states, and that was the predominant view until Lincoln came along. And his idea was, no, we are not a voluntary union. We are a forced union. You do not have the right to secede. You must be forced to stay in the union. Now, you know, I hear people say, Okay, well, that's true. You know, states don't have the right to secede. Okay, really? Well, then that means that the colonies did not have the right to secede from Great Britain. How can we laud Independence Day, July 4th, 1776, and celebrate the Declaration of Independence from Great Britain, which was nothing more than states or colonies seceding from Great Britain?
And that's what the Declaration of Independence states is our right and our duty. And so why even have a states if we go with the view of Lincoln? You're exactly. Absolutely right. And we're skipping this break. Go ahead.
Yeah, so and then turn around and say that the Southern states did not have the right to secede in 1861. I mean, either both are right or both are wrong. You can't have one right and one wrong. Another thing that's lost in this whole debate is that Lincoln hated Andrew Jackson's anti-central banking policy. You remember Andrew Jackson was the last president that we had that really was willing to take on the central bankers and root them out. You know, I mean, he just had a hatred against the whole central bank.
And they love to demonize him all day because he was so tough. He was a runner in the first war, in the war for independence. His brother and mother died in a concentration camp. His dad died working himself to death. I think it was in South Carolina. I've read several books on him. It's been years. And then he was wounded in all these battles, defeated the British when he was a colonel, was in all these duels, shot, stabbed over and over again. I mean, that guy, they called him Old Hickory because he was skinny but unbeatable. Andrew Jackson was like just probably even tougher than somebody like George Washington. That's why nobody even knows about him. And yeah, he did a lot of bad things in modern views because at that time, the Native Americans, by the hundreds of thousands with modern weapons with the French, would pour down out of Canada through Illinois and smash through the Midwest, killing tens of thousands a day. Whole cities were burned. We only see Indian Native American movies out west when they'd already been mopped up and they were being mowed down and killed at Wounded Knee and stuff. But the reason that was going on was because most of those soldiers' parents had been killed in Indian wars where almost everyone was killed. But there's no movies about that. No one even knows what went on or how much of Jackson's family that he had left was killed. I mean, he was just a fighter. And he was an American. And he, more than anybody, is the reason we even have the country today. Go ahead. Sorry.
No problem. Jackson was the last president we had to fight the central bankers. And he literally rooted them out as much as he could, and they despised him, and they vowed to undo everything that he had done against them. And by the time Lincoln came along, if you go back and read the speeches of Lincoln before he became president, he was bold in his assessment that Jackson had, you know, ruined the country, and he was against the central national bankers, and you know we got to bring back that institution into the country, and that was pretty much the platform of Lincoln. The platform of Lincoln had really nothing to do with slavery. In fact, Lincoln himself was a racist to the nth degree, and that's not just a.
I know I've read his letters, and I haven't even gotten into it. People are childlike and don't want to read it.
Oh, I know, but it's a fact. He was a racist. He basically said that the blacks were inferior to the whites. They would never achieve equality, even if they were not slaves. That the whites were the superior race. He wanted to take all of the blacks and ship them all off to, you know, back to Europe or Africa or someplace. So he had a disdain against the black people himself, and that's something that people don't. They've forgotten about Abraham Lincoln. His whole platform was to bring about a forced union and to centralize the banking system.
Yes, but it is true, just to throw in, that the abolitionists were Christians in the Republican Party and did spearhead trying to get rid of slavery, and their pressure by the end or the middle of the war finally got him to do it.
Well, virtually everyone in the country, with the exception of a very few people, saw the handwriting on the wall relative to slavery. Look, the other nations in Europe and in South America, like Brazil and so forth, had already ended slavery, and here's the key word, peacefully. Peacefully.
England was absolutely, go ahead, sorry.
Yeah, there wasn't a shot fired. There was no war. They did it peacefully. America could have done it peacefully. The vast majority of the country, North and South, recognized that slavery was a dying institution. Farm machinery was coming into existence. It wasn't economically feasible.
The cotton gin killed slavery.
It could, was not even economically feasible to continue slavery. The farms and the plantations that would, for some reason or other, want to maintain slavery as a means of production of their crops, et cetera, would be losing money big time. Everybody knew it. Everybody knew the moral evil of it. They wanted to get rid of slavery. Let's remind everybody, too, Alex, that it was the British Empire that forced the colonies to accept slavery.
They wouldn't let us have manufactured goods. We could only have agrarian. That's why people like Washington hated them so much. And then people say Thomas Jefferson owned slaves. Thomas Jefferson put in the first Declaration of Independence to end it. The people at his house were like his family. And he was against the institution. But he couldn't even get rid of it. He tried to, and then they invert that and say that Thomas Jefferson was a horrible racist.
Yeah, that's such a distortion of history and such a mischaracterization of Thomas Jefferson. These men, most of our founding fathers at that point, were involved in various abolitionist societies. They were already involved in means by which slavery could be exterminated in our country. In fact, let's not forget that the trading of slaves ended in 1808, that whenever the Constitution was drafted, the article was in place in it that the slave trade would end in 1808, and it did. The slave trade ended. There were no more trading of slaves after 1808. And all of the flags that flew on the slave ships, most of them were British. They flew the Union Jack. Some were Portuguese, some were Dutch, some were Spanish. Not one single slave ship flew the Confederate flag. To make the war between the states primarily about slavery is the most mischaracterization of history that I can possibly think of.
Well, you're right. And again, it's this inversion of reality. But it's like when they say the NRA is the new Klan, when the NRA on record was an anti-slavery institution and helped arm blacks in the South. They just invert every reality. And yeah, there are a lot of racist and criminal motorcycle gangs and people that like the Confederate flag because it's a powerful symbol. It's been picked up as a symbol of rebellion. But it wasn't really even about that. It was about following the Constitution to the greatest extent.
Right.
I wish the South wouldn't have been manipulated into the war, though. As you know, it almost happened during Andrew Jackson's period, but he was able to stop it.
Yeah, let's not forget what the nature of the Confederate flag is all about. The Confederate flag is designed around St. Andrew's cross. Let me just give a little history here about the flag. The flag, but you know, it was not a racist flag. It was not about bigotry and hatred and racism or anything such as that. It was the St. Andrew's cross. All right, St. Andrew, of course, was the brother of Simon Peter, the apostle of Christ. He was hung on an X-shaped cross at about the age of 90. And as a result, that X-shaped flag was a symbol of Andrew, the apostle of Christ, who was crucified on an X-shaped cross. Andrew was the patron saint of Russia. He's the patron saint of Scotland. The St. Andrew's cross on the Confederate battle flag was designed after the Scottish flag and in honor of St. Andrew. Let's not forget that about 75% of the Southerners in 1860 were of Scotch or Scotch-Irish descent. They were largely Scotch-Irish.
Yeah, that's where Jackson came from as well.
And so that's why when they designed the flag, they designed it around the Scottish flag and the St. Andrew's cross, which of course is a picture of Christ. And that's why, you know, for example, years and years ago, whenever men were not able to write their signatures and they
were an
official document, they put an X. Well, why did they put an X? That was St. Andrew's cross. They were saying, I'm vowing under God that I'm signing this document. This is me. I'm taking a vow to God. And that's why they put the X. When people said Merry Xmas, you know, or they wrote it, Merry Xmas. And what was the X? The X was meaning Christ. It was a symbol of Christ and the St. Andrew's cross. So they were saying Merry Christmas. You know, there wasn't anything derogatory about that. It was a respectful reflection of the St. Andrew's cross and a typical meaning of Christ. So the history of this has nothing to do with racism, nothing to do with slavery, nothing to do with bigotry. And the whole essence here was we will not be dominated. Abraham Lincoln co-authored a 13th Amendment, before the real 13th Amendment that we know today was ever enacted after the war between the states, they co-authored, Lincoln and three others, a 13th Amendment which would have forever codified into the Constitution and permanently ensconced slavery. Now think about that.
Abraham, let's come back and finish with that and then go to phone calls and cover some of the latest news. But Pastor Chuck Baldwin, amazing information. We also sell his book, Render Unto Caesar, written with his constitutional son, constitutional lawyer.
We're
very powerful. We have Pastor Chuck Baldwin joining us. I want to go to phone calls for folks that have been patiently holding on a host of issues. ChuckBaldwinLive.com is where you can read some of his excellent commentaries. But I wanted to briefly talk about the Supreme Court and the rulings we've been hearing. I'm a libertarian, Pastor, but I'm also a Christian, and I understand that there is an attempt at not tolerance, but at conquering the church. And now they're saying, hey, don't preach the Old Testament like they do in Europe or Canada. Everything we said would come. They're now saying, we will teach your children what we want. We will have boys go in the girls' bathroom. It's just an attempt to overthrow the natural order, an attack on the species. And that's a fact, and it fits into the larger globalist plan. It's so diabolical, it's not of this world. I mean, it just as an anthropologist or a sociologist, looking at it scientifically, if I was an alien species and I was in control of the leadership of the planet, I would do all the things they're doing to break down society and destroy the species. I mean, I walk on the hike and bike trail and I see men and women with their kids and the men and the women working together and loving each other. And it's just that great institution. It's what mammals do. It's what higher mammals do. We're above the higher mammals. Obviously, look at what we've done, made in the image of God. But imagine if they said, it's sexist that male killer whales just want female killer whales. We need to teach baby killer whales that, you know, not to get milk from their mommy. I mean, you'd say, you're trying to kill the species. And the Russians say they're trying to kill our species. But then I'm not saying it's space aliens. It's what the Christians have said. It's what Revelation says. How could where they would turn the family upside down, break up the family, the Pope's calling for world government, carbon taxes. It's biblical. So either the Bible's right or the globalists are using it as a blueprint. Now, we all know the Bible's correct, but And how is that so fantastical that we're on a planet in the middle of space with other dimensional entities that want to destroy God's creation and hate us, that resonate with his dark force, and that God wouldn't send someone to warn us, and then the fact that all that information has come forward. But then I look at how I've told people, you've told people what was going to happen. So much of it comes true. They listen to us. We, again, are a tiny reflection of what Christ did, telling people exactly what would come. And I'm kind of all over the map here today. It's just that it makes my faith get that much stronger. Not that I needed to get stronger, but not just being convinced, but totally convicted that we're fighting an evil spiritual force that wants to just flat out kill us. Can you speak to that, Pastor, and then we'll go to some calls?
Yeah, no question, Alex. But let me put this, try to give perspective on this. Let's put the blame where it really belongs. The blame does not truly belong at the Supreme Court level or any other tyrannically inspired government
level. The churches.
Exactly. The pastors and the churches are to blame. Look, in 1954, the church committed spiritual adultery when it took the 501c3 nonprofit tax-exempt status from the IRS and at that point became a creature of the state. It was no longer a church, a part of the body of Christ, the bride of Christ. It's now a creature of the state. The church has been living in whoredom with the state ever since 1954, for the most part, very few exceptions.
And now it's begetting little goblin babies.
Well, yeah, what do you expect to happen? You know, whenever you, when you get in bed with government and you give to government the authority that only God is supposed to have. God is a jealous God, and he's not going to let his bride sleep with the enemy without there being repercussion. So what has happened, I think, with this decision, this Hodges decision, is basically inevitable. It is the fruit of the church that got in bed with the government. And from that point onward, once it got that 501c3 nonprofit tax exempt status, it was neutered and muted and made impotent. You can't get pastors to talk about anything controversial. They won't address any issue that might would offend someone or jeopardize their tax-exempt status. Alex, the church has been on the canvas comatose, cold stone dead as far as speaking out and taking a stand for decades. The result is the enemy has taken the field. The church has fled.
And into that vacuum comes, you can't call yourself a boy or girl now in thousands of school districts. You're a purple penguin. Who could imagine that? Imagine a space cult, you know, like the Heaven's Gate people that cut off their genitals. Imagine if they said, we're going to have Heaven's Gate come in this week and teach you kids, and you can't call yourselves boy or girls. I mean, this is cult-level wackoid.
Okay, but here's my question to the listeners right now. Now, many of your listeners go to church, not all of them, of course, but many of them do. So my question to all these church-attending listeners right now is, okay, we're going on 3 weeks or so since this Hodges decision. How many of you have heard your pastor get up in the pulpit and say a word about this in your church? How many of you have heard a word? I would venture to say that the vast majority of the people that are listening to this conversation right now who went to church last Sunday and the Sunday before that have not heard a word about it from their pulpits. The pastors are not willing to address it because they're afraid of losing their tax status.
And well, listen, they're pulling crosses out of Catholic churches, Methodist churches, liberal Baptist churches, and actually putting, husband and wife teams up there that all they do is push Democratic Party propaganda. They're accelerating the coup, and the church is going from being stone cold on the ground, knocked out, to now being a ring wraith like the Supreme Court nine that will put behind me on TV that are doing this. This is on. And now they're saying ban husband, ban wife, ban boy, ban girl. Notice none of this quenches the thirst of those that wish to overturn the basic biological system.
No, it's not going to quench the thirst. It's insatiable. And this is just the beginning. I mean, right now, where I live in Montana, which is, I think it's a fantastic state, and in many ways it's better than most. But, even here in my state, the school district is having meetings right now. In fact, they're having their final meeting in a couple of weeks, making the decision on adding transgender curriculum into the schools and transgender bathrooms into the schools. Now, this is in Montana. I mean, this is not New York. This is not California. This is Montana. But this is coming down from the Federal Department of Education. All of the school districts are going to be considering the same thing. But the question is, what are the pastors going to do? Look, we have sat back as preachers for the last 50 years and said nothing. We said nothing whenever the freedom and the God-given duty of self-defense was made a license by the government in 1968. We said virtually nothing when prayer and the Bible reading were taken out of the schools in 62. We said basically nothing whenever Roe v. Wade was passed and abortion on demand became the law of the land, killing unborn babies under the law. Most pastors and churches said nothing. Whenever we started this police state in 2001 and the Orwellians began to take over our government and our states, and it's been going on ever since 2001, what have the pastors said about that? Our liberties are going, constant surveillance, we've lost our constitutional government, our Fourth Amendment rights, et cetera. The pastors have sat back and said nothing. Alex, the problem is the churches and the pastors of America have sat back and done nothing. They're scared to death of losing their tax-exempt status. The globalists have held that over their heads since 1954, and so now we are getting what we deserve. The chickens have come home to roost.
That's right, and notice that right as all this happens, the prosperity, all of it is leaving us, and all that is spreading is corruption. And I can get being tolerant. I don't hate anybody, but that's not what was being asked for. This is a conquering. This is a takeover. This is a alien attack. I mean, this is a satanic attack And I'm not even saying the people that are under this control themselves are bad people or in their hearts want to be bad. But clearly, you see, it's a takeover. It never stops. There's never enough. It is slavery to follow and do what these people are telling us they want. And with the whole lifestyle system they're pushing, that just comes with this in history when a society gets ready to collapse. Lesbian feminists like Camille Paglia gets that. I mean, this is a historical fact that all of this comes with a collapse.
There has never been a civilization in the history of the world that has officially embraced, promoted, and legitimized the homosexual lifestyle that has survived. That is simply a matter of historical record. But in America, I think for what we're looking at here is twofold. We're looking at a spiritual issue with the pastors and the churches unwilling to take a stand. Number two, we're looking at the abolishment of our fundamental rights under God, including the right of conscience. Well, this is saying you don't have the right to believe a certain way. You must accept our belief system. It's more than just, okay, we want equality. That's not equality. We demand that you submit your conscience to us. That's a huge difference. You know, the American ideal has always been, I may disagree with what you say, but I'll fight to the death for your right to say it. And that has historically been what America is all about. That's what the freedom of speech is all about. It's what the freedom of association and so forth is all about. But nowadays, these tyrants of the left, these people who want to invoke their ideology upon every area and facet of our lives are saying to us, you don't have the right of conscience. You don't have the right to believe. It's not, you can't say this or that. You know, one of these CNN reporters got up here just recently and said, well, now since the Supreme Court decision, what that means is Judge Napolitano cannot get on television and say the things that he said in the past. Really? A Supreme Court justice doesn't have the right to get on public television and voice his opinion about a subject? I mean,
well, that's
how far this has gone.
They flipped from saying it was tolerance to going, no, we're taking over and we're going to arrest you for your speech. I want to take some phone calls with Pastor Chuck Baldwin. They're all over the map. Sherry, Matt, Omega, Dennis, Joshua. We'll go to all of you. Thank you for holding. Sherry in Texas, you're up first on the subject of ban everything idea. Go ahead.
Thank you, Alex. Yes, in my opinion, this all or nothing attitude, it keeps coming up and it has for a long time now. It's exploitation. And for a purpose, though, it's a way to take what was originally a good idea to take down one flag and use it against the people in order to rile them up and make them vulnerable to violence. It's like pulling our strings. It's pushing our buttons and pushing our buttons. And yes, we can be free, and we don't have to submit to be taken over. We can let things break down and come back if we are aware. This is all exploitation used against us, and to stay away from any kind of knee-jerk reaction and realize, like one wonderful guy named Danny Brinkley once said, be the difference that love can make, because there is something that I think they can never dictate against, and that's our ability to share our abundance with one another. And
absolutely, Sherry, because they want all of us fighting with each other, so they exacerbate differences, take away our basic rights, and replace it with faux rights. Go ahead and finish your comment.
We should never forget where we came from. The one thing that pushes my buttons the worst is that they took out the racial slurs in Driving Miss Daisy, the movie Driving Miss Daisy. What those police said to Miss Daisy and her chauffeur were at the very heart of what the whole movie was about, and we must never forget.
No, I hear you. I hear you. I appreciate your call. Yeah, they're even removing historical things that did happen that were racist because it might be hurtful. They're just turning us into jellyfish. Going back to Pastor Chuck Baldwin before we go back to other calls, I don't know if you've watched the 8-minute video, and that's a shorter version. There's like 30 minutes of it. And first they denied it was real, then they said it was real, then they said it was okay she did it, and you know, now they're throwing her under the bus. But one of the sub-directors of Planned Parenthood in their medical services head you know, on video having a very fancy dinner. It's a perfect setting for the demon bragging about trying to not chop the babies up too small because they want to keep the torso intact because they can't do a cesarean. It's too obvious to the woman. We're going to come back and talk about that on the other side and this video of her talking about selling the organs of babies. We'll be right back. Stay with us. This just broke. We're going to do 5 minutes of overdrive with Anthony Gucciardi to break it down. Facebook censors post revealing secret bill to ban GMO labeling. It's not just our Facebook that's banning it. It's all the other Facebooks. We've talked to other folks that have tried to post any comment on it. This just shows how controlled Zuckerberg and Facebook are. We'll continue to operate on Facebook to reach the sheeple. I want to go to Omega in Indiana. And I want to go to Matt in Tennessee. He's actually first, and others. But Pastor Chuck Baldwin, what did you make of her just enjoying? I mean, it's sickening to watch somebody talk about, you know, their Mercedes-Benz and how it's the best in the world, you know, just to see the fact that they're worshiping it just for what it is. But talking about baby parts, like she's talking about cutlets of filet mignon and all the money they're going to get, truly sickening.
Yeah, and the thing is, we've been talking about this for a long time. You and I and others have been trying to warn the American people as to what was really going on relative to abortion and the industry that came into being as a result of it, the selling of body parts, et cetera. Nobody would listen to us. They all thought we were exaggerating, et cetera. But now we've got, you know, the evidence from the people involved themselves, as you say, bragging about it. I think it just demonstrates how confident they are that they will not have repercussion in any shape, manner, or form to what they're doing. And I think, you know, what the scripture says about the conscience being seared as with a hot iron, I think these people have a seared conscience. They no longer feel the basic human empathy. I mean, it's hard to imagine that somebody could stand up and brag about cutting up children and selling their body parts for profit.
And then they're on a pedestal because they're liberal and they support Jenner, so that makes it all okay.
Yeah, again, I think it just goes back to, A, the seared conscience that they have, and secondly, the brazen boldness that they have that this is not going to be, there's not going to be ramifications for this. This, you know, this is acceptable to society. I mean, so now we've gone from that to, you know, the forced acceptance of a perverse lifestyle, homosexuality, legally, officially in our country, and now it's going to translate culturally into, you know, unisex bathrooms in our schools and transgender curriculum in the schools. And
well, I mean, even Dave Chappelle, whose kids go to a rich, you know, liberal private school, said that in the articles on InfoWars, said he's tired of the lesbians that have kids there bossing him around and trying to make all the men feel weird and like what's the exact quote he uses here and that he has to participate in their self-image. See, he gets that it's their culture is aggressive taking him over.
Yeah, and let's remember this too. I want to get this on the show before I leave, Alex, because it's important that we understand that, you know, marriage until the mid to late 1900s and early 20th century, marriages were never performed with a state license. Never. I mean, in terms of Western civilization, almost, you know, 2,000 years of Western civilization, it's only been the last 100 and a few years.
It's an ancient human private ceremony of the species, so old it goes back to the beginning of us being a true species under God's creation, and that's why they want to destroy it.
Well, the point is that the pastors have surrendered the authority of Christ over marriage. Whenever they allowed the state to license marriage,
just like the Romans 13, just like the 501c3, all of it.
Absolutely, and that's the correlation that I make, and that's what I'm making now in my presentations and in my speeches and sermons and everything. I'm trying to show the correlation between the acceptance of the license of the 501c3 church categorization of nonprofit status in 1954 and the accepting of the marriage license by the state a little bit earlier.
Now that brings state dogma into the church.
Yeah, I've made the decision as pastor, Alex, that I will not marry anyone heterosexual or homosexual if they have a state license.
Great idea. It needs, Christians need to take that back. It's our institution. First Amendment, you have no jurisdiction. Chuck Baldwin, great job. We are back live, breaking censorship news, and it shows how covert it is. And why Zuckerberg goes to Bilderberg and is on such an inside track with the TPP, with his pump-and-dump operation, it's Facebook. Anthony Gucciardi has the breaking report from Infowars.com.
This is really, really disturbing stuff, because for the first time that I'm aware of, talking to some of the developer experts we talked to, some of the SEO people that have ties with Google, this is the most blatant attempt at censorship that I've ever seen from Facebook. Because it's not just blocking all of InfoWars, it's blocking one article on numerous platforms. And so yesterday night...
And then we check with other people, well, their Facebooks, they can't do it either.
Exactly. So we're going to show you some images. It's all on InfoWars.com right now. So there's an article that I wrote called "This New Bill Could Ban GMO Labeling for Good." It's about HR 1599. It's been called the Monsanto Protection Act on steroids. And what it would do is it would literally ban GMO labeling in the United States. And as you can see on screen, if you're a radio listener, I tried to share this article on Facebook, and I received an update that this message contains content that has been blocked by our security systems. And it says, you know, if you think this is a mistake, let us know. And I thought, well, this is a weird glitch, because I'm not immediately going to say, oh, they're censoring me, right? So I kind of left it alone. Then I started getting about 100 emails that it was blocked on Facebook. And then I heard from another major group, March Against Monsanto, which has millions of followers. They couldn't share it. Tens of thousands of people were not unable to share it. And here's what the crazy part is. So I'm going to show you this as well. You try to share this article, and you get this crazy thing, a security check. You know, obviously they know that all these platforms are free of viruses. Now,
they're playing along, acting like you've done something just because they don't want Americans to know about legislation.
Exactly. And, you know, what it's looking like is a lot of people are saying they were blocking TPP-related articles. This is now a per-article blocking.
That's because the word is that's in TPP.
Exactly.
It's banning GMO labeling. So because it's connected to TPP with Congress, it's being killed.
Right. And to be clear, this isn't just some glitch. We've had everyone look into this. I mean, I know what I'm doing development-wise too, but we've had others look into this in the back end. There's no errors. There's no security issue. There are no viruses. And to make it even more clear, it is blocked on InfoWars.com as a feature story, but you can share other feature stories. This is 100% blacked out across the board and on other platforms too. It is blacked out. You cannot share this post. We've tried everything. We've tried changing the title, the URL. It is blacked out. It'll work for 5 minutes after we switch it out, and then it'll be blocked again.
Well, the answer is everybody's going to take this live 5 minutes. We'll put the video up call it Monsanto Loves You and Your Family. Or this video is not censored and see what they do. Or call it Puppy Dogs and Kittens. And then all we're doing is and then they're going to ban the video.
Right.
But they're just testing what they can get away with. It's pretty amazing.
It is amazing, and it ties into some other news that we've seen, too, in these past few weeks. Like, such as this article, Apple Mind Control News is on the way, where they feature what you're allowed to read and what you're not. And then Facebook changes news feed algorithm to affect media content. Social media giant admits post reach and referral traffic could potentially decline.
Oh, yeah. The fix is in. Folks, better not take InfoWars or Drudge Report or WorldNet Daily for granted. Tell friends and family about the broadcast. And I'm sorry to callers. If you give us your name and number, we'll call you back Sunday with the Sunday show and put you to the head of the line. I'm just out of time with this breaking news. I was going to go to your calls, but I couldn't. Also, I skipped a break last hour and never plugged. Buy the books, buy the videos, free shipping at InfoWarsStore.com. We're selling out of X2. I've been telling you it's been happening the last few weeks. It did sell out for 2 weeks. It's going to sell out now. Supermel Vitality is about to sell out. BrainForce is sold out. Liver Cleanse is sold out. Liver Shield. So 6 of our 14 products are sold out. The Prostaguard is back in. InfoWarsLife.com. Your purchase supports our broadcast. While we still have self-funding, voting with your dollars, please take action. Free shipping in the month of July. 25% off on the Molon Labe belt buckles. 10% off on all the t-shirts. It's time to really fund this operation so we can get more reporters. We are launching on TV in the next few months. That's a done deal. That costs a lot of money. Just 10 grand a month for closed captioning, where a real person types everything. Federal law. I'm going to be broadcast on that satellite down to Earth. And if it's going to be on UHF, VHF stations, that's $10,000 a month extra bill. I mean, we need you to buy the products, folks. Get high-quality products. Fund the war against the globalists. We need to get the story out about censorship. They test all the time, then pull back. When we don't get back in their